If I am the last word of this broken sentence of a family, I will have some sort of meaning. I'm glad you're so much better, Papa.
I'm not better. It's why I sent for you, so you may see me as I am.
I always see you as you are, Papa. Beautiful as ever. You look lovely.
That hat's wrong.
I know.
The feather. It's overdone.
How long have you had these rooms?
You are handsome.
And that gives you pleasure?
No, one of my very few.
I'm willing to go with you, Papa. Things have happened, and I've only waited for seeing you till I could be quite sure. I am sure. I'll go with you.
Go with me where?
Anywhere. Here.
I don't believe you've made your mind up to that.
I could live with you even if I don't understand how you get on.
I don't get on.
You're flourishing, Papa.
Oh, do you throw it up at me again that I've not done away with myself?
Well, you know Mama had less to leave than she feared. It makes about 200 a year for Marian, 2 for me, but I give 100 to her and the children.
You weak thing.
The other 100 would do something for you and me together.
And what would do the rest?
Can you yourself do nothing?
I don't see what has so suddenly wound you up.
Aunt Maud has made me a proposal. She says it is time we should understand each other.
I can quite imagine what she means.
Can you?
She means she'll do for you handsomely if you break off relations with me.
So here I am, Papa.
Do you really suppose me in a position to justify you throwing yourself upon me?
You live. You flourish. You bloom.
Oh, you've always hated me.
Her condition is that I shall have absolutely nothing to do with you. Not speak or write, you should simply cease to exist.
And her promises? I'm a poor old ruin of a dad. But I'm not quite the old ruin not to get something.
Oh, I think her idea is I should get a great deal.
I put it to your conscience. It's an admirable opportunity. And moreover, one for which you've really to thank me.
I don't see what my conscience has got to do with it.
I'm not talking only about what you might do for me, but what you might do with me. Use me. I'm still good, well, for a lot of things. There's, in fact, a coach and four to be got out of me. You've really settled to give away half your little inheritance?
No, I haven't settled anything.
But you mean practically to let Marian collar it?
Is it your idea that I should give it to you?
Far from it.
If I were to sign my aunt's agreement, I would carry it out to the letter.
Of course. The only way to play the game is to play it. There's no limit to what your aunt can do for you.
You mean in the way of marrying me?
Marry properly.
And then?
And then? Well, we will talk.
Goodbye, Papa. It may be for a long time.
Why not call it forever?
I don't know what you're like!
No more do I, my dear. I've spent my life trying in vain to discover. Like nothing. More's the pity. If there had been many of us and we could have found each other, there's no knowing what we mightn't have done. But it doesn't matter now.
I wish there was someone here that could serve as a witness that I have put to you that I am ready to come.
Would you like me to call the landlady?
There's only one word you need speak.
If I don't strike you as having spoken it, our time has been singularly wasted. Now, if you can't pull yourself together, I'll take you in hand, put you into a cab, and deliver you to Lancaster Gate myself.
But everything's changed, Papa. There's a new difficulty. Please don't turn me away. I should have you, and it would be for my benefit as well.
Oh. The problem is you're in love. And your aunt knows. And for reasons, I'm sure, perfect, hates and opposes it. Oh, I'm sorry for her. Poor deluded woman, if she builds on you. Go, please.
I shall go my way as I see my way.
Your way, then, will be to marry some blackguard without a penny?
He has every disposition to make the best of you.
Then he must be an ass. I trust your aunt with my eyes closed, and you must take it that I won't hear of anyone she won't. If you really should defy us...
Well,
my sweet child, I think that, reduced to insignificance as you may fondly believe me, I should not be quite without some way of making you regret it.
If I don't do it, it won't be because I'm afraid of you.
If you don't do it, you may be quite as brave as you like.
Then you'll do nothing for me.
I never pretend to do more than my duty. I've given you the best and clearest advice. If it displeases you, go and see Marian to be consoled.
That's what you can't forgive me, isn't it? That I divided my scant share of our mother's money with her and your grandchildren. Not you. Gertie, have you done with your dinner?
Let them go. Lottie, go up. Put up the window a bit.
Yes, the lingering odour of boiled food. You're not used to that anymore. Do what you like. You always do.
What does that mean?
It means that how can you think about anything but this horrid way we are situated?
It seems to me I give you sufficient proof of how much I think of you.
Well, your own business is your own business. And you may say there's no one less in a position than I to preach to you. This poor, poverty-stricken, red-faced widow. I'm getting fat, you know.
You're not.
Do you really consider you've a right to throw yourself away?
I'm not conscious, I can assure you, of the least disposition to throw myself anywhere.
Oh, so you don't feel like you'd like to marry Merton Densher?
I don't know what makes you talk of him.
Because you never do, in spite of what I know. That's what makes me think of him. Or rather, it makes me think of you. If you don't know at this time what I hope for you, what I dream of. If I name him, I suppose it's because I'm afraid of him. He fills me with terror. In fact, I dislike him as much as I dread him.
And yet you don't think it dangerous to abuse him to me?
Yes, I do think it's dangerous. I admit I shouldn't speak of him at all. But I want you to know...
Know what?
That it would be the worst thing that has happened to us yet.
What, because he hasn't got any money?
Yes, for one thing, and I don't believe he'll ever get it. You must have it. You shall have it.
What, to give to you?
Have it first, then we shall see.
You live in a world of vain thoughts, Marian.
Do I? Look how successfully your dress is done. All the trimmings and lace, do they give you pleasure? Do they speak to you? I thought so. I'm talking of no man but Aunt Maud's man, of doing nothing but what she wants. I don't believe in Merton Densher, no, but I believe in her.
That's what Papa said.
He came to you?
No, I went to him. Oh, don't get all injured. I'm not going. He won't have me.
I would not receive you, I can assure you.
He wouldn't take me.
At least he shows his sharpness.
He said he'd curse me if I leave Aunt Maud.
So you won't. You won't, of course. It's your duty.
Yes. Papa's immense on duty.
Poor old Papa.
Anyway, who do you mean by Aunt Maud's man?
Well, Lord Mark, of course.
How does such stuff in this hole get to you?
And who keeps us, me and my poor children, in this hole?
I'm going.
Don't forget to kiss the children. You forgot last time. They cried.
I imagine myself in a garden. A walled garden. No way out. I see a ladder against the wall. So I climb it to see what the world looks like outside of all this. And as I reach the top, I find myself face to face with a man who had, at the same moment, climbed up from his world with the same calculation. I can't stop looking at him. I cannot climb down. He is other than us. Than me.
This is Slow Square, Slow Square!
Watch the doors, miss.
I feel him before I see him. The day and hour are darkness. May I sit here? 6 other people. He is on the other bench at the furthest angle.
that it is like we meet in some bright stretch of desert.
I knew you'd come. I expected you. This moment. Now.
Surf, Kensington!
This is his stop. He doesn't get off.
And already we are much further on than we were. Each link between High Street to Notting Hill Gate takes us further, deeper.
Open the doors!
And we're alone.
May I?
He's next to me.
I can't speak. I say nothing. We rush forward.
Bayswater, Queen's Park, find the gap.
I have to get off.
I'll come with you. Why should we not be seen?
My aunt's going to write to you. I know what she'll say.
What will she say?
She has this idea.
What? That I'm not good enough for you?
Not good enough for her.
And that's necessary?
She's behaved extraordinarily.
And so have we.
She's been giving us rope. If you see her, you must know where you are.
I always know that. But it's where you are that concerns me.
That look. Your look is what I can never get enough of. I take it home with me. You have given me something no one has ever given me.
Wet walks in the park.
Your mind. So rich and mysterious and strong.
I suppose I have the potential for recognition of ideas, but can you coin that into gold?
You live by the mind.
And you have a mind to live, and that seems to me to be so much more.
We're here. We have each other. That's everything.
It's what we don't have. I can feel your aunt watching us from the window of Lancaster Gate. We're out of sight, but I feel her. I don't believe I shall ever be rich.
You're a writer.
Exactly.
You could make a fortune.
But never a living. Would you marry me? Like this, tomorrow.
Let's wait till you've seen my aunt.
And that's adoring.
She makes me afraid I might do something base.
What? Like sacrifice me?
I shall sacrifice nobody and nothing. And that's just my situation, that I want and that I shall try for everything. I never asked her for anything. When our troubles were at the worst, I never appealed to her. She fixed upon me with her wonderful gilded claws.
You make her sound like a vulture.
I was her choice.
What she must see in you?
Everything. And there it is.
Yes, there it is. And you want me to square it with her?
See her.
And grovel.
Do what you like.
I will do as you like, my love. I will help you to the utmost of my power to the rest of this day and the next as you turn your beautiful back away from me. I wait. You keep me waiting. I hate this room. All your massive, florid furniture, your signs and symbols. I won't grovel. I'm not ready for that. I'll be patient, ridiculous, reasonable, unreasonable, diplomatic. I can feel you upstairs knowing I'm waiting, keeping me waiting. Yes, I have your message. I never dreamed of a world so fringed and scalloped. So cruel, these heavy horrors. And what do I have to fall back on? I love the girl. I love the girl. And I walk the desert of my own poverty.
My dear, I do apologize for keeping you waiting.
Don't worry. I have quite taken the hint.
I just wanted us to understand each other.
I'm not afraid to understand.
I have gone a long way with my niece, and I am ready to go much further. I don't care what you repeat to her, and at any rate, there's nothing she doesn't already know. I don't say this for her. I say it for you.
Thank you.
I like you. I know you are good. You are, by my measure, good enough. Good enough, that is, to give up my niece and go your way in peace. But then I have to wonder, are you good enough by your own measure to do such a thing?
It might be my doom to prove so.
She's the finest possible creature. Of course you flatter yourself, you know it. But I know it a great deal better yet. I don't say it because she's my niece. That's nothing to me. I could have 50 nieces, and I wouldn't have brought one of them to this place if I hadn't found her to my taste. Kate's presence I marked early. Kate's presence, unluckily for you, is everything I could possibly wish. I've been keeping it for the comfort of my declining years. I've been saving it up and letting it, as you say, appreciate. You may judge whether now it has begun to pay, am I likely to consent to anything but the highest bidder? I can do the best for her, and I've my idea of the best.
And that idea of the best isn't me.
I didn't ask you to come to hear what it isn't. I asked you to come to hear what it is.
And that's very great indeed.
I want to see her high. High up and in the light.
A duke, of course. And you naturally want to smooth away any hitch.
I want her to marry a great man.
Of course, I'm aware of how little I can answer to any fond, proud dream. You've a view, a grand one, into which I enter. I thoroughly understand what I'm not, and I thank you for not reminding me of it in any rougher way.
You don't really matter, I believe, so much as you think. I'm not going to make you a martyr by banishing you. Your performances with Kate in the park are ridiculous as far as they're meant as consideration for me. I would much rather see you myself as you seem to be, my dear young man. Delightful. I place you in the presence of my plan with which you are incompatible. Come then as near it as you like. Walk all around it. Don't be afraid you'll hurt it. You can do it no harm. Live on with it before you.
She doesn't think I'm dangerous. That's what she wants me to know.
Is that what she said?
You're to marry a great man.
And what is a great man?
I have to go away.
You're not letting her.
No, of course not. Of course not. The paper wants me to go to America. 15 or 20 weeks, a series of letters, strictly social points of view. I'm not in a position to refuse anything.
Yet.
I'm surprised they want me.
Of course they want
me. They don't want the kind of twaddle I just can't do. My tune, as I am.
You're wonderful.
It's all to be done by June. I asked for a day so I could talk to you. I'm to leave straight away.
We must go.
Is it that easy?
We're bound together.
It makes me even less of a threat.
Aunt Maud says you can still see me.
Yes, of course. I can come to Lancaster Gate.
Well, that's everything.
She's sure of my want of money, and that gives her time. She believes in my having a certain amount of delicacy in my wishing to better my state before I put the pistol to your head. She won't spoil her chance by treating me badly. Strange as it may seem, I think she rather likes me. She doesn't disparage intellect and culture. In fact, she would like them associated with her name. I am sure it is quite a pang for her that I am so desirable and yet so impossible.
What an immense affair she must think me.
More than you can imagine.
She'll be relieved you're going away.
Well, since she builds on the gradual process of your alienation, she may take the view that it constantly requires me. It's in my exile that it may languish. What?
I engage myself to you forever. I pledge you every drop of my life.
And I you. All that I am, all that I have.
This was my mother's. Undo it.
You're You're sure?
Yes. Take it. And what of yours?
My ring. I never take it off. It may not come off. here.
Your empty hand.
It's yours. I'm yours.
We belong to each other. No one else.
Your aunt may not agree.
She asked for no promise. So we have not done anything she has not asked us. We say nothing of our engagement.
Until the hour she finds someone.
She must take her risks, and she surely understands them. What we shall have gained is time. And so, for that matter, will she.
Time's everything. And bliss.
Of our secret?
Of us. Of our being as we are.
Beefsteak, oyster pie, and spaghetti. Everything boiled, of course. My cabin is not as small as I expected. I have a small desk at which I am sitting this moment. But often I stand on deck alone. It's cold. One cannot understand the cold until it's completely taken one. It makes you feel each breath and the throb of your heart. I saw an orca looking up at me as if I were the spectacle, and then it slid into the water and lifted its great tail. Like everything fitted. I never felt so alive.
My love, how far you are from me. I'm alone. I'm not afraid of that. That's always been the case. I'm bored. Even books are words. I'm waiting for something to happen. Oh, I don't know if it's the London weather, but everything fades. It's like a photograph, how quickly everything dries and is held in its place.
New York is a big place and rapidly becoming an interesting one. It seems so poetic and tender. I'm walking everywhere. London's so big and black and actual. It's a brute of a place next to this.
Lord Mark. This room is ferocious, Maud. Too much red. I'm afraid I'm about to be devoured.
Yes, I like that about it.
You look well.
I look the same as I ever did, my dear.
Yes, you're always the same. That's what I like about you. Quite wonderful.
Yes, I think I am.
Always doing something for your friends.
You make it sound like a crime.
Praise.
I don't deserve it. It is myself I am mostly doing things for.
Exactly. But yourself includes so many other selves. I never knew a life so touched by others.
What is one's life? Its appearance? The moments it plays?
Wouldn't you call life your ambitions?
I wonder if she understands that.
Oh, I believe she understands it very well. She is perfect.
Would you entertain her if she were not?
No.
Exactly.
Where is she?
Writing letters.
She's not easily understood, which makes her more interesting. What do you want to do with her?
What do you want to do with her? Oh, here she is.
Lord Mark.
Miss Croy.
Will you come and drink coffee and talk to me? I'm horribly bored.
Well, I cannot promise to cure you. Maud tells me I'm indolent.
You are indolent. It is your worst fault.
Maybe your best.
Thank you, Kate. Someone at last who understands me.
I am like an actor on a stage. Each day, I put on my costumes, reset my face. I never miss my mark or forget a line. I go over the same script. I can play comic, ironic. I am pitch perfect. I know how to turn my head beautifully. I know all my best sides. And all the time, I long for my dressing room, where I can strip back these adornments and lay out my heart.
No letters?
Nothing, miss.
8 weeks. Your silence becomes like a shrug that I keep trying to shake off. Where are you, my love?
You still not heard from Mr. Densher? You may leave your letters on the hall table, you know, Kate. You do not have to go out to post them.
I like the walk.
Strange enough, I've had rather an intriguing letter from an American. I suppose that's what she meant to do.
What do you mean?
Oh, an old school friend. Susan Stringham. She made rather a meagre marriage, and I lost her after that.
Lost her?
Well, you know. Let her go. She lives in Boston, a provincial widow. She writes stories for ladies' magazines. I almost pity her.
She's not coming to visit, is she?
She may have something to show.
Oh, don't make me meet her.
She is travelling with a princess. A remarkable thing from New York. She is a striking apparition, apparently. Hair exceptionally red, clothes remarkably black, even for mourning. It's a New York history, loss of parents, brothers, the lot. And beyond everything, by most accounts, a mass of money so piled on the girl's back. Alone, stricken, rich, but most particularly strange. It may be you can give this young New York princess something she craves, Kate.
Me?
Susie knows I can serve up the whole of London on a platter. This princess may be most rare, and therefore a jewel, like you, my darling. We must set you together and see if we can make you dazzle.
The air of the place. So sharp, so deep. The faces, the hands, the jewels, sounds of words, of names, the shapes of the forks, the flowers, the servants, the walls. We are all touches in a painting. I am in a state of vibration. It's too sharp.
I'm afraid I can't really clear up her situation. There's no such thing in London today as saying where anyone is. Everyone is everywhere. Nobody is anywhere. I should be put to, yes, frankly, to give a name of any sort to Maud Lauder's set. Is it a set at all, or is it not? And are there such things as sets anymore? Is there anything but groping and pawing?
You throw up a great many questions, Lord Mark. Do you give them up for too much knowledge?
Maud Lauder is an extraordinary woman. The more extraordinary, the more one knows her.
And her niece, Miss Croy. It seems to me that English girls have special beauty, particularly in evening dress.
Yes. Kate is tremendously good-looking.
And?
And here's the soup. Asparagus. Horribly insipid.
Is it an Englishman's special gift to conceal more than they advertise?
Is that your experience of Englishmen so far?
It is. The few I've met. Are you a young man who is old? Or an old man who is young? You're extremely clever, aren't you?
I'm extremely frivolous.
You don't have a word for you in America. Isn't it the aristocracy?
How did you recognize me?
Your indifference. Did I say that out loud? It's the way you crumb up your bread. And you have recognized me. You have been to my country and threshed us all out. There's nothing for me to explain or brag about. You have the whole picture, don't you? So can you then tell me why I am so different from that girl across the table? or why she is so different from me.
Well, of course, we recognize you Americans, how you work. See you. You're already worrying what you should say to the thick-necked, large and literal gentleman sitting to your left. You poor creatures, the burdens you take on.
Well, you know my desire to be lovely all round is justly founded on the lovely way Mrs. Lauder met us. It's as if she really cared for us, and it's a magnificent fidelity to Susie.
Well, isn't your Susie's fidelity equally magnificent?
Why, it isn't as if she's got anything to give.
Apart from you.
Me? Aren't I rather a poor present? I don't feel like I've been given.
You've been shown. And if our friend jumps at you, it comes to the same thing. It is Mrs. Lauder now who gets the benefit. Look round the table. You're being from top to bottom jumped at.
American, you know.
Made up altogether.
A princess.
New York.
Is there such a thing?
Well, we started out in a grand place just off Fifth Avenue. It was the most fashionable.
She is all that you say, Susie.
I can't promise to completely understand her yet.
Well, that's what makes her interesting.
Sometimes she frightens me.
My niece is the same.
She went for a walk in the Alps. It was getting late. I went after. The vastness of those mountains. That unending sky. There was a vertiginous drop. At the edge of all of it, she stood. I thought she was going to leap. It was as if she held herself back. As if she knew herself reserved for a more complicated passage. It came like a revelation to me. That there was before me something so precious. And I do not mean her gold.
Is there something wrong with her?
There was a doctor.
So why did you come here?
I've had scenery, yes. But what I want of Europe is people. So far as they are to be had, I want human and personal. And all I can say is I thought there would be more of that in London than any place else.
Do you know anyone here?
No. I knew a London man in New York, but he won't be back.
The salmon is extremely fresh, I believe. Almost raw. Won't you try it?
You don't eat either.
It's to take everything in, isn't it? I must do one thing first, then the other. Let me ask you something. Does Maud know much about you?
No. She just likes us.
I mean you particularly. Has your Susie told her?
Told her what?
Everything.
How could you know? Nobody knows. Ask her.
I might. In the meantime, I shall have the interest in seeing what she does with you. That will teach me more or less how much she knows.
How much does she know about you?
Nothing. But that doesn't matter. It's what she does with me. This, for instance, turning me straight on to you.
And you mean she wouldn't if she did know?
No. I believe, to do her justice, she still would. So you can be easy.
Because you're even at the worst. The best thing she has?
I was till you came. You're the best now. You're a success. That's what it comes to. And this is what it is to be a success. It always happens before one could know it. One's ignorance is, in fact, the greatest part of it. All this is nothing, but you'll see everything you can, you know. Everything you dream of.
This was a joke, coming here. We pressed an electric bell in gaiety which won't stop. Now, I'm afraid. I don't know how to make it stop.
Well, I insist on the skins off. Everything else French.
We've got South Devon.
Of course you flatter yourself, you know it. But I know it a great deal better yet. I don't say it because she's my niece. That's nothing to me. I could have 50 nieces, and I wouldn't have brought one of them to this place if I hadn't found her to my taste. Kate's presence I marked early. Kate's presence, unluckily for you, is everything I could possibly wish. I've been keeping it for the comfort of my declining years. I've been saving it up and letting it, as you say, appreciate. You may judge whether now it has begun to pay. Am I likely to consent to anything but the highest bidder? I can do the best for her, and I've my idea of the best.
And that idea of the best isn't me.
I didn't ask you to come to hear what it isn't. I asked you to come to hear what it is.
And that's very great indeed.
I want to see her high. High up and in the light.
A duke, of course. And you naturally want to smooth away any hitch.
I want her to marry a great man.
Of course, I'm aware of how little I can answer to any fond, proud dream. You've a view, a grand one, into which I enter. I thoroughly understand what I'm not, and I thank you for not reminding me of it in any rougher way.
You don't really matter, I believe, so much as you think. I'm not going to make you a martyr by banishing you. Your performances with Kate in the park are ridiculous as far as they're meant as consideration for me. I would much rather see you myself, as you seem to be, my dear young man. Delightful. I place you in the presence of my plan with which you are incompatible. Come then as near it as you like. Walk all around it. Don't be afraid you'll hurt it. You can do it no harm. Live on with it before you.
She doesn't think I'm dangerous. That's what she wants me to know.
Is that what she said?
You're to marry a great man.
And what is a great man?
I have to go away.
You're not letting her.
No, of course not. Of course not. The paper wants me to go to America. 15 or 20 weeks, a series of letters, strictly social points of view. I'm not in a position to refuse anything.
Yet.
I'm surprised they want me.
Of course they want me.
They don't want the kind of twaddle I just can't do. My tune, as I am.
You're wonderful.
It's all to be done by June. I asked for a day so I could talk to you. I'm to leave straight away.
We must go.
Is it that easy?
We're bound together.
It makes me even less of a threat.
Aunt Maud says you can still see me.
Yes, of course. I can come to Lancaster Gate.
Well, that's everything.
She's sure of my want of money, and that gives her time. She believes in my having a certain amount of delicacy in my wishing to better my state before I put the pistol to your head. She won't spoil her chance by treating me badly. Strange as it may seem, I think she rather likes me. She doesn't disparage intellect and culture. In fact, she would like them associated with her name. I am sure it is quite a pang for her that I am so desirable and yet so impossible.
What an immense affair she must think me.
More than you can imagine.
She'll be relieved you're going away.
Well, since she builds on the gradual process of your alienation, she may take the view that it constantly requires me. It's in my exile that it may languish. What?
I engage myself to you forever. I pledge you every drop of my life.
And are you? All that I am, all that I have.
This was my mother's. Undo it.
You're sure?
Yes. Take it. And what of yours?
My ring. I never take it off. It may not come off. here.
Your empty hand.
It's yours. I'm yours.
We belong to each other. No one else.
Your aunt may not agree.
She asked for no promise. So we have not done anything she has not asked us. We say nothing of our engagement.
Until the hour she finds someone.
She must take her risks, and she surely understands them. What we shall have gained is time. And so, for that matter, will she.
Time's everything. And bliss.
Of our secret.
Of us. Of our being as we are. beefsteak, oyster pie, and spaghetti. Everything boiled, of course. My cabin is not as small as I expected. I have a small desk at which I am sitting at this moment. But often I stand on deck alone. It's cold. One cannot understand the cold until it's completely taken one. It makes you feel each breath and the throb of your heart. I saw an orca looking up at me as if I were the spectacle, and then it slid into the water and lifted its great tail. Like everything fitted. I never felt so alive.
My love, how far you are from me. I'm alone. I'm not afraid of that. That's always been the case. I'm bored. Even books are words. I'm waiting for something to happen. Oh, I don't know if it's the London weather, but everything fades. It's like a photograph, how quickly everything dries and is held in its place.
New York is a big place and rapidly becoming an interesting one. It seems so poetic and tender. I'm walking everywhere. London's so big and black and actual. It's a brute of a place next to this.
Lord Mark, this room is ferocious, Maud. Too much red. I'm afraid I'm about to be devoured.
Yes, I like that about it.
You look well.
I look the same as I ever did, my dear.
Yes, you're always the same. That's what I like about you. Quite wonderful.
Yes, I think I am.
Always doing something for your friends.
You make it sound like a crime.
Praise!
I don't deserve it. It is myself I am mostly doing things for.
Exactly. But yourself includes so many other selves. I never knew a life so touched by others.
What is one's life? Its appearance? The moments it plays?
Wouldn't you call life your ambitions?
I wonder if she understands that.
Oh, I believe she understands it very well. She is perfect.
Would you entertain her if she were not?
No.
Exactly.
Where is she?
Writing letters.
She's not easily understood, which makes her more interesting. What do you want to do with her?
What do you want to do with her? Oh, here she is.
Lord Mark.
Miss Croy.
Will you come and drink coffee and talk to me? I'm horribly bored.
Well, I cannot promise to cure you. Maud tells me I'm indolent.
You are indolent. It is your worst fault.
Maybe your best.
Thank you, Kate. Someone at last who understands me.
I am like an actor on a stage. Each day, I put on my costumes, reset my face. I never miss my mark or forget a line. I go over the same script. I can play comic, ironic. I am pitch perfect. I know how to turn my head beautifully. I know all my best sides. And all the time, I long for my dressing room, where I can strip back these adornments and lay out my heart.
No letters?
Nothing, miss.
8 weeks. Your silence becomes like a shrug that I keep trying to shake off. Where are you, my love?
You still not heard from Mr. Densher? You may leave your letters on the hall table, you know, Kate. You do not have to go out to post them.
I like the walk.
Strange enough, I've had rather an intriguing letter from an American. I suppose that's what she meant to do.
What do you mean?
Oh, an old school friend. Susan Stringham. She made rather a meagre marriage, and I lost her after that.
Lost her?
Well, you know. Let her go. She lives in Boston, a provincial widow. She writes stories for ladies' magazines. I almost pity her.
She's not coming to visit, is she?
She may have something to show.
Oh,
Don't make me meet her.
She is travelling with a princess. A remarkable thing from New York. She is a striking apparition, apparently. Hair exceptionally red, clothes remarkably black, even for mourning. It's a New York history, loss of parents, brothers, the lot. And beyond everything, by most accounts, a mass of money so piled on the girl's back. Alone, stricken, rich, but most particularly strange. It may be you can give this young New York princess something she craves, Kate.
Me?
Susie knows I can serve up the whole of London on a platter. This princess may be most rare, and therefore a jewel, like you, my darling. We must set you together and see if we can make you dazzle.
The air of the place. The pitch. So sharp. So deep. The faces, the hands, the jewels, sounds of words, of names, the shapes of the forks, the flowers, the servants, the walls. We are all touches in a painting. I am in a state of vibration. It's too sharp.
I'm afraid I can't really clear up her situation. There's no such thing in London today as saying where anyone is. Everyone is everywhere. Nobody is anywhere. I should be put to, yes, frankly, to give a name of any sort to Maud Lauder's set. Is it a set at all, or is it not? And are there such things as sets anymore? Is there anything but groping and pawing?
You throw up a great many questions, Lord Mark. Do you give them up for too much knowledge?
Maud Lauder is an extraordinary woman. The more extraordinary, the more one knows her.
And her niece, Miss Croy. It seems to me that English girls have special beauty, particularly in evening dress.
Yes. Kate is tremendously good-looking.
And
here's the soup. Asparagus. Horribly insipid.
Is it an Englishman's special gift to conceal more than they advertise?
Is that your experience of Englishmen so far?
It is. The few I've met. Are you a young man who is old? Or an old man who is young? You're extremely clever, aren't you?
I'm extremely frivolous.
We don't have a word for you in America. Isn't it the aristocracy?
How did you recognize me?
Your indifference. Did I say that out loud? It's the way you crumb up your bread. And you have recognized me. You have been to my country and threshed us all out. There's nothing for me to explain or brag about. You have the whole picture, don't you? So can you then tell me why I am so different from that girl across the table? Or why she is so different from me?
Well, of course, we recognize you Americans, how you work. See you. You're already worrying what you should say to the thick-necked, large and literal gentleman sitting to your left. You poor creatures, the burdens you take on.
Well, you know, my desire to be lovely all round is justly founded on the lovely way Mrs. Lauder met us. It's as if she really cared for us, and it's a magnificent fidelity to Susie.
Well, isn't your Susie's fidelity equally magnificent?
Why, it isn't as if she's got anything to give.
Apart from you.
Me? Aren't I rather a poor present? I don't feel like I've been given.
You've been shown. And if our friend jumps at you, it comes to the same thing. It is Mrs. Lauder now who gets the benefit. Look round the table. You're being from top to bottom jumped at.
American, you know.
Made up altogether.
A princess.
New York.
Is there such a thing?
Well, we started out in a grand place just off Fifth Avenue. It was the most fashionable.
She is all that you say, Susie.
I can't promise to completely understand her yet.
Well, that's what makes her interesting.
Sometimes she frightens me.
My niece is the same.
She went for a walk in the Alps. It was getting late. I went after. The vastness of those mountains. That unending sky. There was a vertiginous drop. At the edge of all of it, she stood. I thought she was going to leap. It was as if she held herself back. As if she knew herself reserved for a more complicated passage. It came like a revelation to me. That there was before me something so precious. And I do not mean her gold.
Is there something wrong with her?
There was a doctor.
So why did you come here?
I've had scenery, yes. But what I want of Europe is people. So far as they are to be had, I want human and personal. And all I can say is I thought there would be more of that in London than any place else.
Do you know anyone here?
No. I knew a London man in New York, but he won't be back.
The salmon is extremely fresh, I believe. Almost raw. Won't you try it?
You don't eat either.
It's to take everything in, isn't it? I must do one thing first, then the other. Let me ask you something. Does Maud know much about you?
No. She just likes us.
I mean you particularly. Has your Susie told her?
Told her what?
Everything.
How could you know? Nobody knows. Ask her.
I might. In the meantime, I shall have the interest in seeing what she does with you. That will teach me more or less how much she knows.
How much does she know about you?
Nothing. But that doesn't matter. It's what she does with me. This, for instance, turning me straight on to you.
And you mean she wouldn't if she did know?
No. I believe, to do her justice, she still would. So you can be easy.
Because you're even at the worst, the best thing she has.
I was till you came. You're the best now. You're a success. That's what it comes to. And this is what it is to be a success. It always happens before one could know it. One's ignorance is, in fact, the greatest part of it. All this is nothing, but you'll see everything. You can, you know. Everything you dream of.
This was a joke, coming here. We pressed an electric bell in gaiety, which won't stop. Now, I'm afraid. I don't know how to make it stop.
Well, I insist on the skins off. Everything else French.
We look South Devon.
It's all very well
like talking. Like the Riviera.
I don't think of travelling in this country. Terrible. It's like there's a line round the city and
it's not very well talking about the suffrage of women.
Do you think it inevitable, Bishop, as the abolition of slavery?
I never before put those two subjects in the same sentence.
Do you hear that bell?
Here comes the venison. It will all be chewed.
There's two ways. One, to leave now, quit the city, everything. I see myself for a moment from above. I see myself rise and walk out of this room.
Lily!
Out of the house. Down the grand front stoop without waiting for my coat, and I keep walking out onto that cold street. I feel the coldness on my skin like a shock of life, and I keep walking away. No, I'm running, and I'm lost in the night, running, running, but I am alive. And the other way. I stand on the edge of the world, everything before me. How can I renounce it?
Did you want to renounce it?
Can one choose? I know there is no quick escape. This great assault of life, it must be mine. If I have such a short time.
In that case, I am the way.
I will give into it.
I wish they'd leave the skins on. Would you call this a potato?
You always complain about the food.
Always. More wine?
and the corner is turned. Anything may happen. What did you mean, what Mrs. Lauder would do with me?
Oh, she'll get back her money. Nobody here, you know, does anything for nothing.
You think you know everything, don't you? But there are things you don't know.
The things that I don't. With all the pains I take, and the way I run about the world to leave nothing unlearnt.
Oh, you are blasé, but not enlightened. Familiar with everything, but you're really conscious of nothing. What it all comes to, of course, is that you have no imagination.
Oh, I've heard that before.
There it is, then. You've heard everything. You've heard me before, of course, in my country, often enough.
But never too often. I hope I shall hear you again and again and again.
And what good, then, has it done you?
Oh, you'll see when you know me.
Most assuredly, I shall never know you.
Oh, there will be much more to come.
I must keep myself out of the question. Everything else may come with him, but never that. What, then, does Miss Croy have to gain by being here?
Why, to gain your acquaintance.
What's my acquaintance to her? Oh.
Now she knows we're talking about her.
No, she pities me. She understands all this. She's better than all of you. She's beautiful.
Beautiful in character, I see. Is she so? You must tell me about her.
But you know her longer than I. Haven't you seen her for yourself?
No. I failed with her. It's no use. I don't make her out. And I assure you, I really should like to. So you're wrong, you see, as to our knowing all about each other. There are cases where we break down. I, at any rate, give her up. Up, that is, to you. You must tell me when you know more.
Oh, I make out that she must be difficult, just as I myself must be easy. Let me be easy. Think of me as a cheap exotic as long as I can keep myself with you, Lord Mark, in abeyance.
Here comes the moose. Chocolate, relentlessly. How unimaginative.
Did Lord Mark completely take you up?
Of course, it's my vocation.
Well, he thinks he did. He got the idea, and that's enough for him.
Come and drink coffee.
Oh, yes, yes. Leave me. Leave me.
Actually, he mostly wanted to talk about you. You are much more difficult, whereas I am quite simple.
Well, tell me about your simplicity. That's what it is. I've been watching you across the table. You float.
Do I?
I want you to tell me everything about you, from the beginning. So you are the last of a grand broken line. All that is left. You with your wild freedom, your black dress and your vivid hair. Well, I'm a nobody from Bayswater compared to that. My story's very small.
But to me, it's like you stepped out of a picture. The wondrous London girl in person. I've read about you in novels. I think somehow I dreaded you.
Why?
No, you're much nicer.
So what do you want to do with this London of mine?
Shop! See it. No, I want to feel it.
Well, the old is disintegrating and the new springs up with no invitation.
Would you show me it? Your London.
You know, we could ride the new escalators in Harrods. You get a glass of sherry if you dare to ride it to the top.
Is that a tugboat?
They pull the barges. The tower looks so pretty.
Will you really not look at the new bridge?
They say it will be a right and fine symbol of our time when it's done. I hate it.
I like the colour of it. Like flesh. Close your eyes, we're going under.
What I like best about London is the light. The silvery blue strangeness.
Is the Thames always such a pun?
It's trickier than it looks.
So, you must keep your father, your sister, your nieces and nephews, and your aunt happy, while somehow trying to find some kind of happiness yourself.
I let my aunt keep me prisoner, heroic as I am.
But one must admit it is a beautiful cage.
We admire you.
And the cage is so comfortable, one forgets it is a cage.
And is there nobody else?
What do you mean?
Well, there must be someone.
Here's Greenwich. We get off here.
Kate!
I envy you your freedom, Millie.
Sorry, I didn't mean to pry.
No, it's this river. It makes me melancholic. Well, it's relentless.
Is that a palace? It's spectacular.
No, it's the hospital.
And I envy you yours, Kate.
The colour's perfect for you, have it?
Really?
Of course.
Here's the silk, madam.
Oh, why always gold or green?
Blue. She wants blue.
Do I?
It's the shock of your hair. That's what people can't get beyond. But once you're through that, it's the eyes. Their blueness tells everything.
Your eyes are so black, one can't see you at all.
Blue it is. Choose a hat.
No!
I see you looking at them. Choose one. No, not that one. That one's mine. No.
Would you change places with me? Would you change chances?
You have it. I can't let go of my mourning yet.
Rich as you are, I cannot hate you for it. Well, that must be our last shopping until you promise you will not place the contents of the next shop at my feet.
Champagne truffle?
What can I give you in return?
Tell me about Lord Mark.
Is that all you want?
He left me blank.
Well, it's imperfect. He's difficult to explain. He has, nothing to show, or touch, or prove.
It's as if his value is taken as so great, and yet, on what is that based?
I suppose his value is in his future. You think he's a humbug? He might do great things. On the other hand, it is something of an achievement to be taken so seriously by Aunt Maud. Aunt Maud believes in him. She may often be fantastic, but she knows a humbug.
Has he done anything?
He was in the house on a Tory side. Lost his seat at the first opportunity. That's all he has to point to.
Perhaps he points to nothing that is a sign of his real cleverness.
The one thing the really clever have in common with the really void. Well, he's working Lancaster Gate for all it's worth. Just as no doubt Lancaster Gate is working him.
What do you mean?
Let's get out. Would you stop here? Let's walk in the park. These gardens are my favourite in the whole world. Take my arm.
Explain.
It's simple, really. Everyone who has something to give makes the sharpest possible bargain for it. One must get at least its value in return, of course. I suppose the strangest thing is this may be a happy understanding. People quite like each other in the midst of it.
You mean like Lord Mark and Aunt Maud?
I don't know what he's doing for her. I haven't made it out yet. She is an extraordinary woman.
Because of who she takes up?
Yes.
You then?
You may ask, what in the world have I got to give? That indeed is what I'm trying to learn. She will get it. Trust her.
And what about me?
Oh, you'll pay 100% right through the nose.
Well, I hope something is to be done with me. If the most remarkable woman in England is to do it, so much the better. You know, it's odd she wants us both at the same time.
Well, it shows she's sincere. She gives way to her feelings, and feelings have distinctly popped up with the advent of her girlhood friend.
Yes, and that mystifies me.
Why?
That Susie doesn't bore more.
Well, she certainly bores me.
Oh, you don't know her.
I see nothing in her, nothing to account for. I don't know why you indulge her.
I know why I like her.
She's nothing to me.
You are brutal.
Am I?
And isn't there a wild beauty to that? A strange grace.
Am I really brutal?
Well, not brutally brutal, but what's the word? Indifferently brutal.
Well, you know I make up my mind. I know what I like.
And how quickly you decide.
With so many dangers, one has to.
Well, it is indeed a remarkable world where there are any precautions against Susie.
The porter got me a newspaper. It's quite sordid. I'm enjoying it immensely.
You ride in the park?
We did a couple of circuits.
Don't get a chill.
I love this view.
Where did you go?
We walked in the park.
Oh, come in. Oh, put it on the table. No, I'll do it. Thank you. Tea's here, Milly.
Thank you.
You know, they even bring treats with the tea. We better take it with lemon. We might get carried away.
We are carried away. There is no doubt of it.
Well, in the course of our circuit round the park, it came out our friends at Lancaster Gate are acquainted with that gentleman connected with the English newspaper. You know, who had been with you in New York.
Who?
What was his name? He came to your house 3 or 4 times. Mr. Densher?
That's a surprise. A chance 1 in 1,000.
Both Maud and Miss Croy know him, I understand, rather well. I mean, it wasn't me who brought him in, of course. Maud just referred to this young journalist who'd lately gone to New York. Your wonderful country, as she calls it. I recognize Mr. Densher, of course, and without meaning any harm, I didn't say... There wasn't much to say.
I'm Merton Densher, and I am trying desperately to find New York.
And how does one do that, Mr. Densher?
I walk.
And what have you found?
I've found I like side streets, and that the stretch of Lower Fifth Avenue has a mild and melancholic glamour that I love.
In the summer, after the crowds have left, you wouldn't believe how peaceful it is there.
You know it?
Of course.
You walk?
Always. The first place to feel this city is in your feet. The low rumble and the deep beat of its heart.
Didn't you make him some kind of promise?
Did I?
About visiting him, if you ever came to London.
I don't remember.
You should travel. I would like to show you London in the same way you have shown me New York.
Oh, how have I shown you New York? You've just been in my drawing room a few times.
But often the drawing room holds the whole city. The casual splendor of your whole house, like a happy accident.
Is it?
None of it's for show somehow. It's just for appreciation. Oh, the heavy glories of the London drawing room, all strung up piece by piece.
The gentleman is still in America. He had a great deal to do there. In fact, I may not have thought of London at all if I thought he was coming back.
I said it hadn't been so long as to make you as yet great friends. Was that right?
It's odd that he should so instantly fit. How small the world is.
You know what struck me, though? Maud didn't say much. Have you heard of him from Kate?
Heard? Not a word. Why should I?
Well, Maud asks me to suggest to you that it may be better not to speak of him. That is, unless Kate speaks to you of him first. But Maud thinks she won't.
Is there something between them?
No, I gather not. But Maud's afraid of something. Or perhaps it might be more correct to say she's afraid of everything.
What, of their liking each other?
My dear child, we move in a labyrinth.
Abysses. I want abysses.
You would never do so dire a thing as to come to London without looking me up.
I envy you your freedom, Milly.
Of course, you would like her niece to marry Lord Mark. Hasn't she told you?
Kate said she didn't know what Maud wanted with Lord Mark. Or with her.
Are you all right? You've gone quite pale.
All she has told me is nothing. A drop in the ocean to what she has not told me. So where are we going?
To see my sister. She's quite on another geographic. You won't find her on any social map, that's for sure. Turn the page over and over of the social atlas and read through everywhere, everyone. There, tucked right at the back, you'll need a magnifying glass to see her name, almost not wanting to be found.
He has been here where I am sitting. His eyes have rested on your face. And you have looked beautifully back into his.
We must go over the bridge, for starters. All these separations. What's the matter?
What?
I don't know. You have a strange look. Like you're watching me.
You look so beautiful today.
I'm all edges and corners.
And how well they sit with you.
Oh, Kate, go up to the children. They've been waiting for you. They want a story.
Bertie's in bed. He's coughing again. This house is too damp, Miss Theale. The children take a chill. It's easily done.
Light the fires in their room, Marian. I told you.
Coal is coal.
Yes, and you can afford it.
There's 100 things I can afford, Kate, but which one do I choose?
The house is not damp. It's just freezing. Hello? Hello? I'm a bear.
The children love their aunt. She comes and goes. It's always easier to be more delightful when your stay is short.
They sound lovely.
I can hardly hold on to Bertie. And his sister wants... She's like Kate in that way. The two little ones hardly know anything. And then there's this man. This man who could break everything to pieces.
I beg your pardon?
This person in love with my sister. If you care for Kate, do you care for Kate?
Of course.
It would be quite too dreadful. One must do something.
Pardon?
You must prevent anything coming
of
it.
What?
Mr. Densher and Kate. She hasn't spoken of it.
No.
You must look after my sister. Don't say a word of it to Kate that I've spoken.
Is this man so dreadful?
He is poor as poverty, and I know what that is. It's what my aunt thinks. She won't hear of him. He won't either be a public man or a rich one. If he was public, Aunt Maud might help him. If he were rich, she would swallow him whole. But as it is, she taboos him.
You all think so tremendously of money.
It comes as a subject of indifference easier to some people than others.
Marian, the baby wants you.
Would you please excuse me? Have you made her cry now?
No, Bertie bumped her. He didn't mean to. We were doing donkey rides.
I wait. You keep me waiting. I hate this, my small, shabby questions. My face in the mirror. I want to run away. I don't know what I want to do. I can feel you upstairs, knowing him. And still you don't speak. Do you love him? Do I? Only the future running back towards us will tell.
Bring you anything.
Susie, look.
Matcham House. It's one of the greatest houses in all of England.
Oh, it's beautiful.
You have yet to see its treasure. Drive on. Are you ready to meet charming new people? Bear all the chit-chat.
Can you, Mark?
I'll take your arm to steady me.
No, you look after Susie.
Milly, my dear.
Maud.
Isn't this perfect?
I think the day is perfect.
Summer, full flush.
Look at these pictures.
Look up. The cupola is hand-painted.
It is incredible, as if the sky is moving.
You are incredible, my dear. You look incredible.
I feel quite bland amongst all this splendor.
You must stay with us, Milly. Anything else is impossible. You don't know yet, but you can do
anything. It's as if the sky draws you upwards.
Come outside. It's astonishing.
And they put the fountains on. And a marquee. Oh, could it be more sublime? Iced coffee?
Oh, I need this. Mm. Now, absolutely perfect. There's Kate. Oh, she's the handsomest thing here.
Yes, she certainly is striking.
I wonder how one would place her if one didn't know her.
Oh, one could see she was made for great social uses.
I'm not sure I know what that means.
She's a luxury to be taken about the world.
She's always so right. She is lovely.
You must help me with her, Lily.
With what?
Oh, 100 things. Susie said you know Mr...
Mr. Densher.
No, not here. Here is too perfect. Today, we've come into a fairy tale.
How beautiful she must look to him.
You're all swimming together in the blue, my dear. Oh, look at Mark.
He passes and repasses.
He is our skein of silk, ever in reach of the embroiderer's hand.
She thinks I did this for her, or because of her.
Sit down with Susie.
But we know, don't we?
We did it because of me.
Probably dropped her off with some suit of armor.
Let her think what she will. You and I are different.
You must stay with us. You must make your home with us. You must let us all take care of you a little. You and Kate together, you can do anything.
Millie, have you seen the picture in the house? The beautiful one that is so like you?
Oh, I've only seen some incredible old masters as we came through.
You are the image of this wonderful bronzino. You must have a look. May I borrow Millie?
You already have, haven't you?
Lord Mark?
Here we go.
Oh, you'll excuse me.
Of course.
I was just wondering if you would construe this place as a palace.
Well, if they don't tear it down in the next 50 years, it must be.
I say, Mark.
Hmm?
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
We're looking at this little statuette. How much money would you expect for it?
What do I know about money? Why, you think of stealing it?
Man.
Picture is this way.
I feel as though I'm running a gauntlet. Are you showing me off?
English society, you know, it cuts me in two. They mean you no harm.
They just like to look. What's gone round about me? That awfully rich young American who's so queer to behold.
But nice, by all accounts, to know.
We never asked for this.
It doesn't matter.
They don't know me.
But they want to. Anything may happen. Remember? Kind eyes are kind eyes. It will never be worse than that. Come up. Your bronzino is waiting for you.
Never worse?
Let me take care of you. I'm no fool.
No, that's what I like about you. Out of everybody, you are the only one that tells the truth.
Here she is. Your double.
She is splendid. Her hands. Her face. So handsome in sadness. And her hair so high. Before it faded, it must have been the same color as mine. Her eyes of other days. Your jewels. Your wasted reds. You were great. But you have no joy, for you are dead. Dead. You are dead. I'll never be better than this.
Than her? You scarcely need to be, for surely that is well enough. But you are better, because splendid as she is,
Can she really be good?
No, I didn't mean... You don't understand. Everything has been so beautiful today. And it may never be so right again. In this moment, I am completely alive.
Oh, we must talk about these things.
Oh, I don't really see the resemblance. Of course, her complexion's green, but I feel several shades greener.
It's down to the hands.
Her hands are not as large as mine.
Oh, you go all around her one better, which is just what I said. But you're a pair. Do you really not catch it?
I don't know. Can one ever know oneself? I don't imagine it has occurred to anyone.
I can see it has occurred to somebody. Here's Kate.
You've noticed, have you, that I'm not original? You know how one likes to be. But the likeness is so great. I wanted Lady Aldershaw to see.
Marvellous.
There you are, Millie, if you want to know. And you are superb.
I was just saying the same.
Superb. Superb. Of course I had noticed you. It is wonderful. The likeness, the hair. You see, I wonder if you could give us the pleasure of coming to visit one afternoon.
Lady Aldershaw, why don't you walk me around these gardens? I want you to talk me through all the species of rhododendron. So I'm thinking of getting some for home, you know.
Well, if you don't mind...
Here you've got some seeds from the Himalayas.
Eastern Tibet have some of the finest plants.
Eastern Tibet?
I must find Susie. I need to sit down.
The window seat, here. Millie, are you ill?
Is this how you look at him? You know him. You know him, and you never said.
I'm Merton Densher, and I am trying desperately to find New York.
And how does one do that, Mr. Densher?
I walk.
And what have you found?
I've found I like side streets, and that the stretch of Lower Fifth Avenue has a mild and melancholic glamour that I love.
In the summer, after the crowds have left, you wouldn't believe how peaceful it is there.
You know it?
Of course.
You walk?
Always. The first place to feel this city is in your feet. The low rumble and the deep beat of its heart.
Millie. Millie.
Say his name once.
I'm Merton Densher.
What is it?
I won't blame you for not telling me. I won't hate you for your reserve. I trust you. I will trust.
Are you all right?
Will you do me a great service tomorrow?
Any service in the world.
It must be secret.
Is it something bad?
To deceive Susie?
Oh, is that it?
I mean, completely.
Oh, that's better.
Will you come on a visit with me? To Lord Stretz?
To whom?
He's a doctor. The greatest of medical lights, if I believe I've got hold of the right man. I have written to him, and he has named me the hour of 11. But I realized I can't go on my own. The maid's not good enough, and Susie's too good.
And I'm somewhere in between. Happy thought. What's she too good for, anyway?
Well, she'll worry if it's nothing, and worry you more if it isn't.
What in the world's the matter with you?
It may be mere fancy.
Could one be so universally dazzling, yet so seriously menaced?
That's what I want to find out.
Then let us find out.
But I must ask for the promise of absolute silence.
But if you're ill, can your friends remain in ignorance?
Well, if I am, it must come out. But I can go on a long time. That will be my advantage. I can die without it being noticed.
You're extraordinary. What a remarkable time to talk of such things.
Well, we won't talk.
You can have everything. There's nothing you can't do, nothing you can't have.
So Maud tells me.
We adore you.
You're wonderful.
No, it's you. What would become of me?
You'd bear it.
I would not.
You'd pity me, but you'd help me. And I trust you.
Oh, Millie. More iced coffee.
Look at the eyes of my dead sister.
Come on.
She knows all of it.
Is it out?
I'm to come again.
What does he say?
That I'm not to worry.
So he allows you're ill?
I don't know what he allows.
But how could he in so few minutes?
He could tell by looking at me. When I go back, he'll have thought me over a bit. It'll be all right.
When are we to come again?
You never mention him.
Why do you never name him or mention him?
I'm Merton Densher.
No. Now the ice is broken, I shall trouble you no more.
You'll come alone?
Don't tell anybody.
You ask a great deal in proportion to what you give.
So? Tell.
I don't want to tell. I don't want you to keep from me how you really are.
You see for yourself how I really am.
He must have liked you.
Oh, doctors. I hope he didn't like me too much.
So you'll bring Susie?
Not until I've seen him one more time.
You came alone?
Yes.
Wasn't there a lady with you on Wednesday?
Not the lady who's travelling with me, a different one. I've told her.
What have you told her?
That I visit you in secret.
Who else will you tell?
No one.
Well, it makes another friend.
Yes, but really, what difference does it make? It's delightful, but useless. Nobody can really help. Can they? Well, you may be able to. I wanted you to see me just as I am. Start with the worst. I'm not afraid.
You know where we are, then?
Yes.
You have no relatives at all?
I'm the survivor of a general wreck. When I was 10 years old, there were 6 of us. But they died of different things.
And I'm sure you have an excellent spirit. But don't try to bear it all. Hard things have come to you. But you must not think that life will be all hard things. You have the right to be happy. Make up your mind to it.
I have.
You can depend on me, but I am only one element in 50. We must gather in plenty of others.
So you do want to see someone? Get at someone who cares for me? But you see, I can do exactly what I like. Anything in the whole wide world. I haven't anybody to ask. There's not a finger to stop me. I certainly have the means.
Then do it. Do everything that you can.
You can do nothing.
I will send you a small prescription that will be made clear to you. And let me, within a few days, come to see you at your home.
Then you'll see Susie.
There's one thing. You ought to get out of London.
To the continent?
By all means.
Then how will you see me?
I shall follow you up.
Shall I, at any rate, suffer?
No.
So live.
My dear young lady, that is exactly what I'm trying to persuade you to do.
There's no safety now. It's gone. All its lightness. It's day after day. Now I must carry something quite different. I want to get lost. I don't care. I can walk and walk. I can choose at this corner which way to go.
Now's your time.
Fine, Wilkes. A penny a lot.
Oi, oi, what do you think of these here? Penny a bunch. Here's your turnip.
Cooler. Cooler.
Let go, you yob.
Ask her.
You all right, miss? You're a bit off the beaten track.
Am I? Not really. I am lost. And it's not as dangerous as I thought it would be. I choose which way, which corner. Which street? Regent's Park. Where did you come from? So many people here. Wanderers, like me. Tired, like me. Just in the same place. In this grim, breathing space, asking the same question of life.
Why? Why doesn't she love me?
I can work. I can work if I have to. The baby can go to mother.
Meeting the same common anxiety.
I don't want to fight. I don't want to. But if I tell Father, I bring him shame. Mother's so afraid. All this death. Death.
Horror. Horror. Why didn't I stay at home? They said this would happen. This is what they hoped would happen. All proved right. I don't want to see them. I don't want to see any of them.
We could live if we would.
See? I can be alone. I'm not afraid to be alone.
If I could just find a way to hold on to the money. No situation. I am lost. No more. No more. Gin and milk. I'm a man. I'm not gonna drink this away. I have a coin. One coin left. I will take it home to Rose. Or drink it.
We would live.
You demon! You call to me!
If we could. All of us, down on our stomachs, turning away, burrowing, ignoring. This place, stripped to its bones, rises up. This great, grey city. You who demand your rent, the rent for my future.
You know I cannot pay.
Well, what? Tell me. Maud's coming up in the ladies' lift. You better be quick.
It's all right. He's lovely.
You mean you've been absurd?
Absurd?
There's nothing at all the matter.
Nothing to worry about. I shall need a little watching. I can do, in fact, as I like.
Oh, my love. It is, as I was sure. You can do what you like.
I have to get out of London.
Oh, to beastly climate.
For pleasure.
Where?
Oh, you must help me decide.
Not dressed, Millie.
I thought I might let you all go on alone.
The party will be disappointed.
I just can't climb the social stair this evening.
I'll stay with her. You can pick me up on the way back.
Susie will go with you.
Will I do?
Well, my dear, you're better than nothing.
It's so hot in here. Will the sun never set?
Oh, go onto the balcony, Kate. Breathe some air.
Where's that ornate shawl, Millie?
The mauve. In the wardrobe, I think.
Oh, thank you.
Do you remember what I asked you at Matcham?
About Kate?
Would you do something for me?
Which is?
Susie said you met Mr. Densher in America. She can't hear. Would you name him to Kate and perhaps find out whether he's back?
I have never named him and she has never mentioned him.
No, she wouldn't.
Is he back?
It's about the time.
Can you not ask her yourself?
We never speak of him.
You disapprove of him?
I disapprove of him for her. She doesn't care for him.
And he cares?
Too much.
So what can I do?
You can find out where they are.
Yeah, you think they're deceiving you?
No. Kate knows my views, and she is still with me. In that way, she shows her loyal assent of them. My views don't provide a place for Mr. Densher, much as I like him.
You like him?
Yes, don't you?
I did. 3 times in New York.
People may be very good, but not good for what one wants.
Yes, when what one wants is something very good.
Does this trouble you?
No.
If it's too much of a bore, don't dream of asking.
I'll help you as far as it goes to help Kate herself. If he has come back, he will feel he should come to see me. Then there we shall be, except that he won't find me.
Will you run away? So you'll deal with Kate directly? Or will you run away from her too?
Is it your own belief that he is with her?
Does this shawl work?
Sometimes move can be so wrong, it's right.
That's yes, is it? Has Kate gone?
No. I'm here.
Do you hear his name hung on the air? Did you hear everything? There is something different about you. Some strange advantage. He's here, isn't he? With you. All that you are is his.
You know.
He's in London. Right round the corner. He's here.
I thought they'd never go.
Maud was disappointed.
Good. She deserves disappointment sometimes. I love this time of night. As the darkness rolls in, I come alive.
You look like you could conquer anything.
You mustn't always romanticize me, Molly.
I don't.
Oh, the things I could teach you.
What does that mean?
Want a glass?
No.
What do you think of Aunt Maud?
I think many things about her.
Let me tell you something. Aunt Maud is nobody. She isn't anything. She isn't anywhere. You mustn't think she's a good friend. I can't let you. That perfect day at Matcham, she can't give you that again, so don't expect it. Now, Lord Mark, he's all very well, but he's not the cleverest creature in England. He weighs everything out in ounces, and indeed each of them are waiting to see what the other puts down.
But hasn't she put you down?
Yes. I am on the counter, when I'm not in the shop window. In and out, I'm whisked. It is the position and price of my aunt's protection that is being considered. The bore is she wants him for me. But he's put it all out since your arrival.
If I'm any part of his alternative, he better stop where he is.
Truly? Always?
You want me to swear?
No, it's enough.
I'm not in the way, believe me.
It doesn't help. He won't make up his mind about me.
Give him time.
I remain but one of his ideas.
Oh, probably the best of them. Why do you bring this up now?
Just so you know me. Know where you are.
You say so much about what Lord Mark wants, but what do you want?
My honest advice to you would be to drop us while you can. You can do awfully better.
What do you mean?
We've not really done for you the least thing.
Yes, you have.
You would have had it some other way. You're under no obligation to us. You won't want us next year.
I will.
Listen, Susie has the best conscience in the world, but she's enchanted with all this. You should not take your people from her.
But without Susie, I would not have you.
You may yet have reason to hate me.
Why would you say such things?
Because you're a dove. You're a dove.
Yes. That is what is the matter with me. I am a dove. Oh, aren't I?
And do you know what we do with doves?
That's what you think I am.
Piece by piece. Feather by feather.
And how does a dove act? Each time. Each moment.
Drop by drop.
So I will be a dove. And that will hide everything.
We tear you to pieces.
I can't hold out. Not against Maud, not against impatience.
You've been travelling. And you've been thinking too
much. I have nowhere to take you. Have you noticed that? Here we are, hiding between beer and buns.
Today, I don't care who sees
and
me.
And tomorrow? Tomorrow is a baser creature, all alarm and precaution. If I asked you to drive away with me, now, alight at my house, now, come up the stairs, you would not come, would you?
Meet me tomorrow.
Where?
I don't know. One of the museums.
Oh, this is a mistake.
Why?
Because we cannot hold out. It makes me ill. Look at you. So splendid, even here. You cannot be as you are and ask me to do the impossible.
I will find a way.
And there you apply your subtle sedative.
Meet me at the National Gallery at 10.
Well, I suppose it's better than a railway station or the street. Kensington Gardens are out. Too much of a taste of our old frustrations.
Merton!
It won't appease me. Waiting is a game for dupes.
I could lose myself here. There's no questions. I leave them outside. Join hands in a circle so vast. Opticians, you turners. I am not strong enough now. Perhaps that's the moral of a menaced state of health. To sit in public places and count Americans.
Handsome. Well, if you choose to say so. In the English style, of course.
What are you looking at? These paintings are Dutch. Mr. Densher.
Miss Theale.
You're home.
Yes, yesterday.
Millie.
Kate.
You know you each know other. Miss Croy, Miss Theale.
Millie Merton.
We met in New York. Miss Theale dreaded I might write about her.
I wasn't interesting enough.
Well, we met in London, and she is. You are.
Extraordinary.
And you two know each other. You came here together?
Merton loves the Titians. The hunters stepping into the sacred sanctuary of Diana.
So you two didn't know you were both coming here today?
I somehow didn't seem to tell.
It was spur of the moment. Sir Luke's coming to the house. I wanted him to meet Susie without me being in the way.
Why?
Because I'm sick of talking about myself. Doctors. And I've been sitting here watching Americans. Are we so unmistakable?
Ask him. He's the expert.
I have nothing but admiration for your compatriots now I've seen your country.
Did you see Washington?
I did. Wait a minute. You two really know each other.
We were together last night.
Extraordinary.
Well, why so? Everybody knows everybody in London. Why shouldn't that stretch over continents?
Listen, what are you two doing now? Come and have lunch with me at the hotel. I'm beginning to lose my breath from all these vistas.
Oh, we were just about to leave.
They have fresh oysters.
Well, Kate?
Lunch is always delightful.
No one lives above a certain street. Everybody does lines and rules. And yet there's so much of New York that's still possible. They're not afraid to tear it all down, try it another way. That's what I love. Everything's drawn out, yes, just like here. More so in some ways. But there's still space. I walked from edge to edge of the city. Space for so much else, even upwards.
I never see New York like that.
And you Americans with all your honour. We pretend we have honour here, but it only covers our lies.
But is honour always truth? Is it not just pride?
Americans are so serious, especially you young ones. Bright too.
You don't see me, do you?
I hate the word bright. What does it mean?
It means still interested in the world and not yet cynical.
I'm not cynical. Just a little jaded. It's the London weather. It's too grey. There's not enough extremes.
Don't let this woman rub off on you, Millie.
You'll only ever see me as that young American girl you've always treated so kindly. It's a matter of course. Of course.
Now, I love the Rockies.
Could anything ever be real between us?
Here's Susie. She's all feverish glitter. It must have been bad news from your doctor friend.
Tell me why we stayed so long.
I like oysters.
You know her better than you said you knew.
Do I?
You said in your letter she was just a new and amusing friend.
How well we all played our surprise. I mean, you knew I knew her. I knew she knew you. And she knew...
What did she know?
I think she thinks she knows about us. What do you think of her?
I think there are many Miss Theales in New York.
No, you're wrong. She's quite extraordinary.
Is she?
You'll get to know her.
Why? What can she do for us? You think we could meet at her hotel?
So long as they're with us or near us.
Ah.
They'll speak to Aunt Maud, but they won't shut the door to us. A friend always helps, and Milly is a friend. She likes us. She likes you. Make something of that.
Why can you not take me as I am?
Trust me. I see my way. Only believe in me and it will be beautiful.
So there's a sign of Aunt Maud coming round. Remember, as supremely clever as we are, she can play with us quite as much as we can play with her.
She doesn't want to play.
What then?
You need to come and see her. After all, it's she who's really in love with you.
Aunt Maud?
Yes.
You make out everyone's in love with me.
I don't say everyone.
You just said Miss Theale.
I said she liked you. The way she looked at
you. We were talking.
Come to that. I do say she loves you. There you are. That's the good she'll do us. It makes a basis for her seeing you, so that she'll help us go on.
And what sort of basis does it make for my seeing her?
Oh, I don't mind.
Don't mind my leading her on?
Don't mind her leading you.
Well, she won't, so it's nothing not to mind.
You'll like her. She's exquisite, and there are reasons. I mean, others.
What others?
I'll tell you another time. Those are enough to go on with.
To go on what?
Why, just seeing her again. It's no more than decent of you.
Oh, I shall call again, naturally.
Yes. I shall meet you there.
Are you there all the time?
She receives me for myself, that is, herself. She thinks no end of me. We are in, she and I, ever so deep.
Then I confess she's beyond me.
She, of course, doesn't know I care for you.
What?
Well, she thinks I care so little that it's not worth speaking of. Have you been supposing she knew?
About our situation, of course, if you're such friends. You've denied it to her.
We've never spoken of you.
Never?
Strange as it may appear to your glory, never.
But Maud hasn't spoken.
Very probably, but of you, not me.
But how can she not know me but as part and parcel of you?
Maud? Oh, her line is to keep all reality out of our relation. She won't for a moment have allowed to Milly that I've in any way, as they say, distinguished you.
And you don't suppose that she might make it out for herself?
No, I don't.
Not even after bumping into us at the National Gallery. Don't you think she would have seen?
That you're mad about me, yes.
Well, doesn't that prevent?
Her loving us? No. She's like that.
And you can show your love or not as you like.
Not where you are concerned. But Milly only sees that I'm decently good for you.
Very good indeed.
Yes, very good indeed.
You may have to do some explaining.
Then I'll explain. I will explain.
And what will I do?
Recognise a difference it must make if she thinks...
Thinks what?
It's getting late. Get me a cab.
It always ends like this, doesn't it? Separation.
Over here.
May I jump in with you?
You're going in the opposite direction.
Have you even told your aunt I'm back?
Not yet. I will now. She'll have a dinner. Wait for her telegraphic expression. Be nice to my aunt. Show her how clever you are. But don't let her see you're trying too hard or she'll be on to us.
Lancaster Gate.
Go to see Milly.
You mean you'll be there? But it won't give us privacy.
You'll see.
Why won't you come to me?
You'll see the difference it will make.
I don't understand. You mean the difference it will make if Milly believes that I somehow hate you?
I shall hate you if you spoil for me the beauty of what I see. Drive on!
Isn't Kate charming when she wants to be?
Miss Croy? Well, she's always pleasant enough. She knew.
What? Kate knew that you were full of Lord Strett.
She spoke of nothing, but it was slightly disconcerting. She seemed to want to help me through. What I mean is, she saw I was taken up with something. She's a person who guesses. But she doesn't matter, Milly.
Nobody matters, Susie. Did he mind that I wasn't there to see him? Was it more simple just to have it out with you?
Oh, we didn't have anything out, Milly.
I suppose he liked you awfully.
Oh, my poor child.
Isn't he good and beautiful, too? You're just the right people for me. I see it now. You must simply see me through. I'll be as easy as carrying a feather. We'll have beautiful times with him, don't worry.
I'm not worrying, Milly. He told me I can help you. Of course he told me that. Why else am I here with you? He said to help you do as you like.
I must first find things I like, then.
I think you have found some. One, in actuality.
I just wanted you to be comfortable about him, and he you.
Which of them are you talking of?
Oh, not Mr. Densher. Though, if you can be comfortable about him, so much the better. What do you think of him, now you've seen him?
I think he's very handsome.
Well, that will do for the first time. I've done what I wanted.
What was that?
To see him.
There will be plenty of opportunities.
The best is not to know. I don't know. Nothing about anything. Except that you're with me, so it's all right.
Almost certainly it's all right. Lord Strett sees no reason...
That I shouldn't have a grand, long life.
Well, what I mean is that he didn't say anything that he hadn't said to you.
He tells me to live.
But you want more.
No, I don't want, as I assure you, anything. I am living.
Mr. Densher, do be at ease to sit.
I am never sure which chair to choose.
America has changed you.
I probably ate too much.
And was the food reasonable?
Oh, in some places, exquisite.
I was always afraid of the size of the cabins on the steamboat, and that is why I have never been.
I think you would like New York.
Would I?
And New England, more so.
And you know our American friends?
Well, only Miss Theale.
We are going to have the most intimate dinner. You know, I would like to see New England. Bostonians seem somehow like us. Quite pleased with themselves in an underplayed sort of way.
It is a beautiful country.
You must help me map out my journey. It's something that stood at the back of my mind like a question mark. Oh, here's Kate.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Let me look at you, my darling.
And now I will not show how much I love you. You are like a picture, an idea.
Yes, perfect.
An actress, like you said.
Is this dress really...
I have bought the ticket.
Too many frills?
Your wig, your paint, your jewels are impeccable. Your entrance greeted with the proper applause.
The gloves arrived with the bracelet.
I am lost. Who am I in this play?
Frills are frills.
You and your manager will put together your performance. I am a spectator in the cheapest seat.
Oh, here's Milly.
I need to speak to her.
I'm afraid she is not well enough. She sends wild regrets.
Millie's not coming.
Is it true that Miss Theale has not made the same mark in her own country?
It won't be the first time we have taught Americans to appreciate their native products.
It's not that she's funny, though she is weird, but that's precisely her magic. New York hasn't been aware of its luck.
Well, there are plenty of people who are nothing in America who are taken up over here.
You don't know her at all, do you, Mr. Densher? Not the least bit.
Well, I don't know much, except that she was kind to me in New York. I was a poor, bewildered alien, and I appreciated it tremendously.
You weren't there, Susie. You don't know how far things went.
I wasn't away long.
And I wasn't there long either. She's beautiful, but I don't say she's easy to know.
Well, you're right about that. I see her with such intensity. I see her so much more than I see almost anyone. But then I discover that is not knowing her.
She's a thousand and one things.
Like all of us, perhaps she only shows the part she wants to be seen.
Oh, Kate... Is this the great
you
world?
See, you may have found Milly, but it was us, all of us together, who have developed her.
Oh, she's not capable of change in that way.
You mean she's not a type like us English?
Yes. Sometimes I would like to put you all in a book and see what I could do with you.
Serve me up fine or serve me whole. It fills me with dread.
Are we allowed?
To seem not to know each other once you're here would be to overdo it. She won't leave us alone for long.
What's wrong with Milly?
She likes you too much.
Then why didn't she come?
Perhaps she is bad after all.
Why does Susan not go home, then?
She's commissioned to tell Milly all about you.
Well, what will she report to Milly about this? Our present disregard for appearances.
Aunt Maud has her so engaged she won't notice.
Is she ill?
Tonight? No.
But she is ill.
Her doctor says the greatest thing for her is to be happy.
That is surely the great thing for everybody.
But what if she can't be?
Then she must be. She shall be.
If she's as ill as she looks, she'd scarce be a question for us. They're supposed to be leaving town, but they've pulled up since Milly found her at the National Gallery.
Don't be ridiculous.
You have made Milly change her mind. She doesn't know whether she'll see you again. She may not, but the future has opened up before her as a dark, confused thing.
After the tremendous time you've all been telling me she's having.
There's a shadow.
Is it a case of surgery?
She sees Sir Luke Strett.
The great doctor. Him of the 50,000 knives.
It isn't the case she first supposed.
It's another?
It's another.
Examining her for what she supposed, he found something else?
Something else. If it's there, we shall know in time. He's waiting, watching.
Well, then he oughtn't to scare us.
She's scared. She has so much to lose. She wants more.
Well, she can't have everything.
If you can imagine an angel with a thumping bank account, it's open to her to make the very greatest marriage.
Well, then, what good on earth can I do for her?
Console her.
For what?
I shouldn't care for her if she hadn't so much.
Did you really just say that?
I shouldn't trouble about her if there was one thing she did have. She has nothing.
What do you think of Mr. Densher?
I like him.
She does love life. To have met a person like you.
You've been magnificent.
She has you all arranged.
You have, it strikes me.
Milly won't be magnificent if she marries him.
I use what I have.
But isn't it magnificent to marry the man you love?
You're what I have that's most precious. And you're, therefore, what I use most.
You handle everyone.
I don't handle Kate.
You mean she cares for him?
Kate thinks she cares, but she's mistaken. You don't know. That must be your line. Or rather, your line must be you deny it utterly.
That she cares for him.
Deny that she so much as thinks she does. Deny that you so much as heard it.
Milly won't ask.
Are you sure?
Yes. Luckily for me, I lie badly.
I lie well, thank God. And there's nothing else so good. One must always do the best.
I believe that if she's ill, she's really ill. She'll really live, or she'll really not. She doesn't want people to know. It's a ferocity of modesty. I don't know, a kind of intensity of pride. And then...
What?
I'm a brute about illness. I hate it. It's well for you. You're sound as a bell.
It's rather good for yourself that you're strong as the sea.
You give it all up so beautifully.
Oh, I give up nothing. I cling. It's a pity he isn't better.
Well, if he were better, you would like him for your niece, and in that case, Milly would interfere.
Oh, I don't like him for Kate. I like him for myself.
That's the best way.
If I were living for myself, I shouldn't at all mind him, believe me.
So you want me to make up to a sick girl?
Plenty others will.
Others are free.
So are you, my dear.
You're prodigious.
Of course I'm prodigious.
Good evening.
I don't know whether you know Lord Mark, Mr. Merton Densher, who's just come back from America.
Oh.
Maud's with Susie.
Oh, and Miss Theale, I suppose.
Milly's unwell. Was compelled to disappoint us.
She's really bad, I trust.
I've just been reassuring Mr. Densher, who's as concerned as the rest of us.
We must take great care of her. This way?
Yes.
Lord Mark!
Your aunt's man.
Immensely.
I mean, for you.
You judge.
He's interested in Milly?
Yes.
What does your aunt think?
She doesn't trust him.
Takes him to heart, yet thinks he cheats.
What people think of their friends.
And what do you think?
I don't care for him.
And Milly?
No, she has no sense of social values or knows who's who or what's what.
That's why she likes me.
Precisely. She doesn't resemble me, who at least knows what I lose.
So that's our writer.
Charming, isn't he?
Charming.
He's a friend of Milly's, too.
The Englishman in New York.
The world is shrinking.
Intriguing. And he's Kate's friend, too, by the looks of it.
Does he have money?
No.
So what's the difference between...
Save in the sense of being uncle to a duke. He's grand enough. The thing's his genius. Oh.
You always have some way to meet me, don't you? How could I look at another woman?
You draw me out. I exist in you, not in others.
Don't fail me. It would kill me.
What do they talk about?
You, I imagine, Mark.
Well, then I think I'll go through and break it up.
Mr. Densher's leaving. Lord Mark, come and talk to me.
Susie, call for coffee. I will walk out with you, Mr. Densher. So you will go and see our little friend?
She's leaving town, isn't she?
Well, she won't go until she's seen you. We shall go with them.
What good will that do me?
You'll come out to us.
Oh.
I'll write to you.
Thank you.
This is the occasion of your life. Do not lose it. I can smooth your path. Her fortune is a real fortune.
I'm much obliged to you for the handsome offer.
Of what doesn't belong to me? But there's no reason that it shouldn't to you. You don't know how far I've gone for you.
But I see how far you're going.
I'm the most honest woman in the world. But I've nevertheless done for you what was necessary. For me, it has the weight. Don't you understand? I've told the proper lie for you.
You've told her that Kate doesn't care for me.
Now I depend on you to make me right.
There are no lies. I've come to revisit a friend. I like her. We met in New York before any of this. They told the lies. Not us. Not me. How are you, Miss Theale?
I am as you see me.
I'm sorry you couldn't make it last night.
Oh, it was nothing.
I don't love him, Milly. Do with him what you like.
So, tell me the rest of your trip.
She does love me. You do love me.
Mr. Densher, don't feel sorry for me.
No, enough of my jawing. I've overdone it. Tell me about London. They say you've come but to conquer.
Oh, how could I help being the feature of the season? What do you call it? The theme of every tongue?
It's strange, isn't it? When you meet someone early on, then absence causes you to miss the stages and steps they take. And then much further on you meet them, do you feel very different?
No. Yes, yes. Funny, at first I used to hear a bell in my head.
A bell?
It was a warning.
Of what?
Of losing myself.
And did you?
Part of me.
And how's that working out for you?
I don't know. I'm still working it out. No, I didn't lose myself. I just changed. I suppose you decide.
To become something different. It's called survival.
London's quite complicated, isn't it?
Lots of webs.
No one breaks them.
You do. That's why you're such a success.
Because I wear ridiculous hats.
Don't be cynical.
Don't you ever get tired of all these complications?
Yes, I do. I really do.
Would you like some tea?
I'd love some.
Would you bring the tea?
So what becomes of you? You take a country house?
No, we go abroad. Somewhere of high air.
Do you come back?
When the wind turns. What of your summer?
Work. The mercenary ink. My holiday's over.
I'm sorry you had to take it at such a different time from ours.
Could you not stay?
No. All these webs, I'm scared of making some stupid mistake. The way not to make it is to get to a distance and see all this from there. It'll keep it fresh for my return.
So you will return?
Isn't London awful in winter?
No, I like it. It's less of a mob.
Ah, thank you. I'll do it. As it is?
Yes. Come back. Try us once more.
Who do you mean by us?
I mean all of us, ready to surround you with sympathy.
Sympathy?
A pale word, much nearer worship.
Near then, as you like. The person I mostly come back for is Kate. I'll do anything for Kate.
Oh, I know what one would do for Kate. I do understand any amount of devotion to a person so charming as Kate. It's the good turn she'll do us. Her working for your return.
I'm in her hands.
Don't let her bully you.
Would you call it bullying?
What she does? You know, sometimes I don't feel as if I know her enough to understand what she really does.
Come to that, I don't either.
I know I've gone too far, but it is true. What is that? It sounds like the Queen arriving.
Oh, it's my carriage. Please don't look at it. It's extremely ugly. Huh? Oh, it's really awful, isn't it?
It's only pleasantly pompous. It seems to me to be delightfully rococo.
Oh, dear.
You occupy a position, the Eye of London, thanks to which your carriage also occupies one. Anyway, you're going out. I mustn't stand in your way.
No, it's... I just... Would you like to come for a drive with me?
Your carriage is ready, miss.
Am I allowed to ask you that? Is it too forward?
You are allowed to ask.
You have other things?
No. Yes. I would like to go with you. It's a charming idea.
10 minutes, please. I must get ready. There are books and things. I'll dress very quickly.
Your spontaneity. Kate wouldn't have done that. Would she? No, she has done it. Things like it. How could this have anything to do with you, Milly? You are so free. But you are not advanced, whereas Kate is so backwards and yet advanced to a high degree. I can't straighten it.
Miss Croy.
Here you are. Where's Milly?
Gone to get ready for a drive.
Are you going with her?
Yes. With your approval, which, of course, I have taken for granted.
Well, my approval's complete.
Which is, of course, at your so lively instigation.
I don't think I'll wait.
What, after coming?
I came for news, but she must be all right if she's...
What have you told her about me?
Ask her if you like. You're free.
She's doing this for you, you know.
In that case, you can do a little for her.
I'll do nothing for anyone in the world but you.
Good.
Then you swear.
Swear to what?
That you like me. Since it's all for that, I'm letting you do, well, God knows what with me.
If you don't believe in me, hadn't you better break it off?
With you?
With Milly. You might go now and I'll stay and explain to her why it is.
What would you say?
That you find you can't stand her.
Won't it make it rather more sure there's something between us?
Oh, I don't know. It will, of course, greatly upset her, but you needn't trouble about that. She won't die.
You mean she will? Swear again you love me.
Here. There's nothing between us
isn't
here.
There? I'll do all you wish.
If you're as good as that, I go. Tell her, finding you with her, I wouldn't wait. She'll understand. Mind you be kind to her.
And leave the rest to you.
Leave the rest to me.
Here I am in that ridiculous hat.
Oh. Kate was here. She's gone. She hadn't known she'd find me.
I'm so sorry. But if... Of course, I often see her.
Let's go. Shall we?
Yes.
Traces the ceilings. Look! The faces on the cherubs change as the sun moves.
I could spend my whole life looking at it.
And the balcony!
Come out.
You're a princess in a palace.
No, no, grazie.
Your own mooring.
It's all make-believe.
Have you minded being here alone?
No, it's when things speak to me most.
Oh, I won't disturb you, don't...
No, not you, Kate. Don't you see? Here we can take off our masks. We can talk like we used to.
Yes. By the way, I must go and meet Maud and Susie. They're all ready for St. Mark's.
You like it, though, all this?
It's perfect. I couldn't have dreamt it better. Will you not come with us?
No, I like it here.
Hey, we're on our way!
Wish me luck.
Yes, let me be alone. Take them off, I don't care where. Absorb them, amuse them, detain them. Drown them, kill them if you will, so that I may just a little, all by myself, see where I am. I need light. And that is close enough.
There is a visitor, Signorina.
A man?
English. How do you call? Very dry.
Lord Mark.
You want him to wait?
No, Eugenio. He's not as bad as he looks. Show him in.
Signorina.
I'm so glad no one else is here to spoil it.
Why have you come to Venice?
An impulse. I was shivering at Carlsbad and blue. Simply caught the first train. I heard from our friends...
You could overtake them at the Rialto. Or the Bridge of Sighs.
What a temple to taste.
Want me to walk you around?
A general prowl? How marvellous.
And this is the ballroom. The Salone.
Wondrous. Decorated to an inch of its life.
I never, never need to go down.
You don't go about?
Just here.
So you mean you're really not well?
What is my value? I won't last, but my money will. Does that intensify your vision? No. No. That ugly motive doesn't sit in your cool eyes. And after all, I am glad to see you. You are my one easy relation.
Well?
I go about here. I don't get tired of it. I adore this place. I think I'd like to die here.
Oh, it's not good enough for that. That requires picking. Are you in trouble?
You really want to know?
Do you imagine I can see you suffer and not say a word?
You won't see me suffer, don't be afraid. That's why I like this. It's so beautiful in itself, and yet it's so out of the gangway. You won't know anything about anything, and you don't. No. Not even you. I am very badly ill.
And you don't do anything?
I do everything.
What's everything?
Everything's this. One can't do more than live.
Have you advice?
I have the best advice in the world. As I say, live.
Oh, live.
Well, it's immense for me. I shan't have missed everything.
Why should you miss anything? Since you believe in advice, take mine. I know what you want.
I think I want not to be too much worried.
You want to be adored. Nothing would worry you less. I mean, as I should do it, it is so. You're not loved enough.
Enough for what?
To get the full good of it.
The full good of it, which consists in finding oneself forced to love in return, that I might find myself forced to love you.
Oh, forced? Is it so inconceivable?
To be so favorably affected?
To believe in me?
To try, in return for your trying.
Shouldn't have to.
As a healing and uplifting passion, it is in truth deficient. Come and look at the breakfast room.
Why do these people keep so much furniture? Whichever way you turn, you're going to step into something. How pompous this all is. Look, we're all in love with you. I'll put it that way, dropping any claim of my own. You were born to make us happy. You must listen to us.
No, that is just what I mustn't do. I won't listen or receive or accept. I can't make a bargain. You must believe that from me.
But you want somebody.
You oughtn't to have come to Venice to see me. You have much older friends than I. Have you not come for your best friend?
Miss Croy.
Maud.
Do you want me to marry her?
I'm just saying it's not as if I'm turning you out into the cold world. There's a very warm and expectant world waiting for you at the moment you choose to take it up.
You want me to marry Kate Croy?
Maud wants it.
What's the use?
Because she's handsome and clever and wonderful. If I were a man, I would adore her.
You think she's to be had for the asking?
Try.
So you really don't know?
I know, yes, that a particular person's very much in love with her.
And by the same token, she's very much in love with a particular person.
Oh, you're wholly mistaken.
It's not true.
It's not true.
Are you very sure?
I speak on the best authority.
Maud's?
That's not the best.
You take it from Kate?
From Kate herself.
Then she's thinking of no one at all?
No one. She's given me her word.
And what do you call her word?
What should you call her word?
I've not asked her. You apparently have.
We're very intimate. She naturally tells me things.
You mean she made of you, of her own movement, the declaration you quote?
She said she had no private interest.
She took an oath to you?
She left me in no doubt whatever of her being free.
And thereby in no doubt of your being, too. You have another visitor. On the canal. Tell me his name again.
Mr. Merton Densher.
I must go.
Venice is one of those extraordinary places that is as you imagine it.
Does that disappoint you?
No. I still get lost here. I know it could swallow me whole.
So you won't stay where you are?
The hotel's full of cockneys of all climes. Germans, Americans, English. Too loud and not sweet. It sounds anything and everything but Italian. I'd like somewhere more private. I had a place last time I was here, far down the Grand Canal. A shabby asylum, but it had a sense of pomp and circumstance yet somehow, I don't know. I was somehow initiated into a more homely Venetian mystery. Green shutters. I like that. I might walk down.
Do you think all this too much of a museum?
It is a museum, but without fatigue, if you know what I mean. And something else. We float.
It's like being under a spell, isn't it?
I didn't mean to interrupt.
No, he was just leaving.
So you're just staying here, keeping quiet?
I don't call it that. Not with all this, the art, the history. It has set off a whirlwind of suggestion in me that never drops.
Then we are blown together, you and I.
I hope you will not be bored.
You're here.
Oh, good afternoon.
Well, I'm glad you two are staying cool. It's so hot.
It is you who have placed me here. You. It's perfectly done, but for what? Oh, your pure talent for life. Thanks to that, here I am. No will left of my own. I must go. I think I will walk down and see about those rooms.
You'll come for dinner.
Yes. Good afternoon. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. I'm going to neglect St. Mark's for the last. How can you stand in a line to look at angels?
I have done everything you wanted. What have you done? Nothing.
nothing whatever that I want. I need proof.
And so you took them?
I couldn't resist. My ancient padrona, her smile all a radiance, she pretended to recognise me. Everything so refined in its shabbiness.
He likes that sort of thing.
I move in on the morrow.
What's it like?
It is the humblest rococo, a Venetian interior in a true old note.
Sounds quaint.
Even these high chambers, Milly, though they are 1,000 grand things, are not that.
Oh, a challenge.
Then it's your plain duty on some near day to invite me for tea.
And this from a lady who will not make effort for a parish feast.
Or an autumn sunset.
For Titian or Giambellini, she will not come down. But for you.
Oh, hush.
Oh, Milly, your frankness, sweetness, sadness, brightness, your disconcerting poetry. Whatever I have received my old rooms for, I have not received them for you.
You're doing beautifully.
Am I?
You're wonderful. You're beautiful. What time is it?
12:10. We've time yet.
Then we must walk. We must go towards them.
They're still in the shop. They're safe for 30 minutes. What's wrong with Milly?
She just didn't come down this morning.
What does that mean?
That you miss your daily tete-a-tete.
Such a hush in the palace.
There's a hush now. Don't you feel it?
Can I ask you something?
Anything. Let's keep walking.
What was Lord Mark's so very superficial visit the other day for?
He came to make Milly an offer of marriage. She declined.
And then he left.
Well, he couldn't quite on the spot turn around and make up to us.
So, when I turned up, I found him leaving her. That's what had taken place.
She didn't tell you.
Oh, how great an ass he made of himself.
You are in love with her, you know.
And what does Maud make of him?
He's not committed to us. He was having his try.
And come back afterward to you.
Oh, but he has had his try at me, so it's all right.
You refused him.
I didn't let it come to that. I've been discouraging.
Oh, you've treated him beautifully.
I'm glad you can still be jealous.
Well, I take from you what you give me. Only you know what you give me seems to me the larger and larger size of the job you would have me do for you. What you expect of me, it never seems somehow what I expect of you. There's so much you don't give me.
And what is it I don't?
I give you proof. You give me none.
What then do you call proof?
You're doing something for me.
Am I not doing this for you? Do you call this nothing?
Nothing at all.
I risk everything for it.
With your aunt so bamboozled, you risk nothing.
We ought to be there. I mean, when they come out.
They won't come out, not yet. I don't care if they do. Good God, if you'd only take
me. We've gone too far. Do you want to kill her?
Aunt Maud.
You know who I mean. We've told too many lies.
I have told none. Rather than lay myself open to the least appearance of it, I'll go this very night.
Then go.
I'll tell any lie you want, any your idea requires, if you'll only come to me.
Come to you?
Come to me.
Where?
My rooms, which are perfectly possible. We can arrange it with 2 grains of courage. People, in our case, always arrange it. There is nothing for me possible but to feel that I am not a fool. That's all I have to say. With you, I can do it. Without you, it's over. I must be sure.
Please take your hand out of my arm.
Oh, you two. We have bought the most delightful lace. Shall we breakfast?
Again.
Can one breakfast too often?
I know I could drink coffee.
Florian's.
Perfect.
Kate, go and find a table.
I'm going.
I'm so glad you're here.
It's a very wonderful experience.
In the shade!
Is Milly worse?
No, she's marvellous.
So she'll be with us at dinner?
No, she's keeping herself. There's to be a little party.
All this grandeur.
Well, it's lovely, isn't it? I want the whole thing. Bringing out the glory of the place makes her really happy. Sir Luke and his niece have arrived from London. It's for him she wanted to do something, to let it begin at once. So I greatly hope that you'll...
Stay on?
Tonight. There's to be music.
Why has she sent for Sir Luke Strett if, as you tell me, she's not worse?
Well, she hasn't sent. He came himself. He has wanted to come. He was coming from the first for his holiday. She has known that these several weeks. You'll meet him at the party. Tell him what you think.
What I think? Of Milly?
Yes.
That's none of his business.
This is my world now. This is everything.
You look incredible. I never saw you just in white. You look different. Younger. Fairer. Have you done this for your doctor?
I have done it for you.
The one thing I held in my mind was that we met before all this. This isn't just Kate's idea. It's your idea and my idea.
I must acquit myself as hostess.
Do you think her good enough now?
You know how good I think her.
Everything suits her. Especially those pearls. I'll trouble you to look closely at them. She's a dove. And one somehow doesn't think of doves as bejeweled.
She is a dove. Her spirit. And how we all nestle under her wings to a great increase of our immediate ease.
Pearls have such a magic that they suit everyone.
They would suit you?
Yes. I see myself.
You would be splendid. It's the one thing I cannot give you.
Yet. She isn't better, you know. She's worse. But that's nothing to do with us.
Isn't it?
No. We make her want to live. Tonight, she lives. It's wonderful.
She is beautiful indeed.
She's doing it for him, her doctor. She can't deceive him.
None of us are deceived. Do you know, I'm surprised Maud thinks me disposed of, if I am disposed of only to a girl who's dying. I don't, upon my honour, make out how all this serves anybody.
It helps you to serve me. It gains you time.
For what?
For everything. For anything that may happen.
Time for something particular that you regard as possible.
I am taking a trouble for you I never dreamed I would take for anyone.
But there need be none whatever between us.
Yes. Put it together. I'm not doing all the work for you. If you want things named, name them.
Since she's to die, I'm to marry her.
To marry her.
So that when her death has taken place, I shall in the natural course have money.
You'll in the natural course have money. We shall in the natural course be free. Yes.
And to propose then. Marriage on the spot.
Oh, I can't go into that with you. You must act as you like and as you can.
How can you like this? If you say you love me.
I don't like it. But I am a person who can do what they don't like.
I can't make out how you could even bear it.
When you know me better, you will find out how much I can bear. All you have to do is to stay.
And proceed to my business under your eyes.
No. No, we shall go.
Go? Go when? Go where?
In a day or two, home. Aunt Maud wishes it now.
Then what becomes of Milly?
She stays on, and you stay with her.
Alone.
You're old enough, with plenty of Susie.
Oh, it makes everything fit.
Everything.
So, you leave her here to die.
I believe she won't die if you stay.
And that's all that's necessary.
Didn't we long ago agree that what she believes is the principal thing for us?
What if she doesn't accept me?
You can but try.
Yes, but one has to try a little hard to propose to a dying girl.
It isn't as if she's dying when she's with you. Look at her.
The candor of your smile, the luster of your pearls, the value of your life. For you do live.
She's looking at us. You'll stay then, on your honor.
Without you?
Without us.
And you yourselves go at latest?
Thursday.
I'll stay on my honour if you come to me. On your honour.
We must not stand here together all
week. If you decline to understand me, I wholly decline to understand you. I'll do nothing.
Nothing?
I'll go off before you. I'll go off tomorrow.
And if I do understand?
I'll do everything.
Well, I understand.
On your honour?
On my honour.
You'll come?
I'll come.
No one may come here but you. This place. This room. I shut you in. You are in all of my poor rooms. I keep you here, my love. Vanished. You are gone. You are gone.
Why did you stay?
To write.
You'll do your book here.
I hope to begin.
You haven't begun?
Well, only just.
And since you came?
I think I've broken some ground.
I've made an awful mess of your time.
What I'm hanging on for is to repair that ravage.
Then you mustn't mind me.
You'll see how little I'll mind anything.
No, I mean if you want the best part of your days.
Oh, I'll make shift with the worst. The best will be with you.
Can I still come to your humble rococo?
Will it be safe for you to leave the house?
Safe? You think me so awfully bad.
I believe whatever you tell me.
So I'm splendid.
I know that.
I'm capable of life.
I don't doubt that.
I want to live.
If you want to...
I will.
That I believe.
I can.
You must.
So can I pay a visit?
Will it help you to live?
Every little helps. I don't want to miss anything.
You can come whenever you like.
Sorry. It's no matter. I'm an awful bore. I don't want to drive you away.
You won't drive me away.
I don't want to come. It's over.
You can do anything you want. You're free.
Well, I don't complain.
No, I know you don't complain.
And now, about your book.
Oh, I'm not doing a book.
You're not writing?
Oh, I don't know, upon my honour, what I'm doing.
Then it's not for your book.
What I'm staying for.
I ask too many questions. You stay because you've got to.
Isn't it enough to stay for you?
That you must judge.
I might kill her. I am mixed up in her fate, and her fate is mixed up with me. One false move will snap the coil.
I want to show you something. I found something. Up here. Come up. It's a library, half hidden. What is it?
It's the light. It blinded me a moment. All these books. It's incredible. Like it's all been carved out and hidden away.
I slept up here last night. I couldn't sleep. It was too hot. I came and lay on this couch. I defy sleep. I defy oblivion. I looked at the stars and everything became so divinely true as to light up the whole of life suddenly and make everything clear. At dawn, I gazed up at those medallions and arabesques. See them? Everything became so still, I hardly dare breathe. Just the water. And then, without knowing, I slept the sweetest sleep.
Sognavo di case. Adesso sogno solo d'acqua.
What does that mean?
I used to dream of houses. Now I dream only of water. Of here. Where am I? I know this street, do I? Everything's so familiar, and yet, which way? This, the old bridge I've walked over 100 times. Or am I somewhere completely different? I love this courtyard. The way you step in and out of the sun. It's so hot. Come down.
No, I've got the best view from up here.
Ah, but can you smell the flowers?
Oh, I can smell everything. My senses are so ripped open, it hurts.
You all right?
Oh, I love the city. More than New York, I think. Am I allowed to say that?
I like it more than London. You could be forgotten here and it wouldn't matter.
Matter?
To me. No one would know where I was and I wouldn't care. All this would be grand enough. I don't know if I can explain it.
This whole other world, just a step away that we never knew. No, no, grazie. We sit.
You know, it's the tide. That's why everything keeps changing. Every day, the city's taken apart and put back together again. The colours. You're cold.
A bit. I don't mind.
You want more grappa?
A splash.
Don't let it go to your head.
I think everything's gone to my head.
The sky's so bruised.
I said to someone once, I didn't think I could be more alive than I was in that moment. I was wrong. How can one not live? I have no defences left.
I must keep very still. No vibration. I am up to my neck. And there is deeper. So much deeper.
Eugenio, the gate.
The Signora Padrone is not receiving.
Receiving, but I...
Neither of the two ladies are receiving.
Is she poco bene?
I cannot say.
Has something happened?
I think the ladies are a little fatigued. Just a little.
Something's happened.
I must go. Good morning, my friend.
No message? No invitation?
What has broken the spell? Everything is obliterated. Everything we have been living on. For the thing that held us can bear no shock. And the shock, it has come.
Waiter. Cameriere. Un altro caffè?
Sì, signore.
You. Why are you here? Sitting there reading your paper like it is your right. Lord Mark, you have seen Milly. She has received you, and now I find her door shut.
Why?
She has turned her face to the wall.
She's worse.
I don't know how she is. And that is why I've come to you.
Is she dying?
She hasn't so much as named you. We haven't spoken.
About me?
No more than if you were dead.
I am dead. Is she dying?
Then you know.
Yes, I know. And you know everything?
Not everything. That's why I've come. You've been extraordinary.
She doesn't speak at all, not just of me.
Of nothing. Of no one. She doesn't want to die. She lies there clinging to it all. I thank God that she's quiet. It would kill me if she were to tell me.
To tell you?
Only what harm you have done her. I don't know. I come and talk of her here with you.
Does she hate me?
I don't know. How can I?
Would she see me?
Would you like to see her?
If she could bear it, I'd do anything.
There is one thing. You know what it is. If you deny it to her, that might do something.
If I deny what?
What Lord Mark told her.
And what did he tell her?
That you've been all the while engaged to Miss Croy.
All what while?
I only repeat what he told her.
I saw him in the piazza. I knew he wouldn't have come for nothing.
He came for exasperation.
Because she refused him.
How do you know?
I know it. But I don't see what good it does him.
The good he thinks may be to come. He doesn't know what he's done to her. Only we, you see, know that.
She kept from him what she felt.
She was able, I'm sure, not to show anything. He dealt her a blow, and she took it without a sign. He's an idiot of idiots. One could almost pity him. He has such a good conscience. He meant her the least harm. He intended none, whatever.
He only, of course, meant harm to me.
He has been unable to swallow what happened.
I saw that.
Yes. And he also saw you.
Then it was just revenge. Didn't he know? See her, feel her, judge her as having for such a suit as his not perhaps more than a few months to live.
He has doubtless been aware of what you speak of. Just as you yourself have been aware.
He's wanted her, you mean, just because of the money?
Just because of the money.
Shall we have lights?
Not for me.
Nothing?
Not for me.
Where has he been since he was last here?
London.
With Maud? He will have proposed to Miss Croy. That's what has happened.
It's you who must judge.
Well, I do judge. Miss Croy's refusal of him will have struck him as a phenomenon requiring a reason.
And you have been clear to him as the reason?
Not too clear, since I'm sticking here. He has believed that I may have a reason at Lancaster Gate, and yet at the same time have been up to something in Venice.
Up to what?
God knows. To some game, to some duplicity.
A monstrous supposition. Will you deny it to Milly herself?
You're absolutely certain she believes it.
Judge.
Do you believe it?
What I believe will depend upon your action. You settle it. I'll believe you down to the ground if to save her life you consent to a denial.
But a denial of what?
Of everything. If I try and persuade her to see you, will you do that?
Welcome, my friend.
She will see you now.
Milly.
Waited a fortnight to visit me.
Do you have news?
Up to a day or two. Haven't you?
Is she still alive?
Don't you know?
Is she dead?
Not yet. Was it terrible?
Yes. But I don't think that, though I'll try, I can quite tell you what it was. What it was for me.
I can believe how dreadful for you. Much of it must have been.
So Luke Strett has gone back to her?
I believe he's there now.
Then it's the end. He'll stay to the end. He's magnificent.
I think she's magnificent.
Oh, you don't know.
She is, after all, my friend.
You would have been sure of that, would you?
Of course.
So what about Lord Mark?
Lord Mark?
You haven't seen him?
Not since he saw her.
So you know?
Certainly.
And the rest?
Not rest.
It was what took place when he visited her that killed her.
Oh. Susie never said anything.
She gave up beyond all power to care, and that's why she's dying.
Oh.
She was living by will, very much as you said.
I remember.
He told her that you and I were secretly engaged.
But he doesn't know
that. That doesn't matter. She did by the time he left. When did you last see him?
That was what made her worse.
She turned her face to the wall.
Poor Milly.
She thought there was nothing between us. Well, as far as you were concerned.
It wasn't through anything you did that she gained her certainty. She got that from me.
It's handsome of you to take your share.
Do you suppose I deny it?
I don't suppose anything.
It wasn't your idea.
Don't go into that.
Wouldn't it have been possible to deny?
For whom?
For you.
To tell her he lied?
To tell her he was mistaken.
Are we engaged?
Of course we're engaged, but to save her life...
It wouldn't have done any good.
You mean she wouldn't have believed you? Did you try? You never met again?
No, we met. Once. She sent for me. I went to her. That night I left Venice.
Wouldn't that have been your chance? Of course, I know that seeing her, you could judge.
I did see her. If I'd denied you, moreover, I would have stuck to it.
You would have broken with me.
Yes. So you see how right I was not to commit myself. If it ever appears to you again, remember what I say.
You've fallen in love with
her. Well, then say so. With a dying woman, why need you mind? What does it matter?
Wait till she's dead.
She never asked me. I was with her 20 minutes.
She never wanted the truth. She wanted you. Just wants more to look at her.
She had nothing to ask me. Nothing, that is, except not to stay. After he'd... She thought I'd taken myself off. Then she found days later I was still there. It affected her.
Of course.
If I was staying for her, she wanted it to end. She wished me to know there was little reason for it. She wanted to tell me so herself.
And she did?
Yes. As she desired.
And as you did?
No. Not as I did. I hadn't desired it in the least.
I'm glad.
Glad?
You did the right thing. In staying. And that was all?
That was all.
That you mustn't wait. That was the point, to see her die.
That was the point.
And all this took 20 minutes.
I didn't time it.
Did she receive you in her room?
She received me, just as usual, in that grand old salon, in the dress she always wears from the corner of her sofa. Do you remember what you originally said to me?
Oh, I've said so many things.
You said she wouldn't smell of drugs. Well, she didn't.
So it was almost happy.
I don't think I can attempt to say now what it was.
Did she show anything of her feeling of being misled?
She showed nothing but her beauty and her strength.
So what proof have you that she was ever alienated?
She wouldn't see me for days and days.
Well, she was ill.
She would have still received me.
Well, you know.
And I know from Susie.
What does Susie know?
Everything.
Everything?
Everything.
Because you told her?
Because she's seen for herself. I told her nothing.
Oh, you don't need to be afraid of Susie.
I'm not afraid.
Do you want tea? Well, it's wonderful. You'll have some.
Hadn't we better wait for Maud? Propriety and all that.
Oh, you needn't mind now. We've done it.
Squared her.
You've pleased her.
What a brute I must be.
A brute?
To have pleased so many people.
You've done it for me. And the great thing is that Millie's satisfied, which is what I've worked for.
Satisfied to die in the flower of her youth?
Well, at peace with you.
Oh, peace!
The peace of having loved.
Is that peace?
Of having been loved. That is, of having realised her passion. She wanted nothing more. She has all she wanted. You may think it hideous that I should yet pretend to draw conclusions, but we've not failed.
Oh.
We've succeeded. She won't have loved you for nothing. And you won't have loved me.
I want you to be in no doubt, my poor Merton, that I'm with you to the end. She is stupendous. The way that poor girl wants to live. Why in pity shouldn't she, with everything to fill her world? The mere money of her, the darling, if it isn't too disgusting at such a time to mention.
I pretend you're already dead. It's the only way I can bear this. This waiting, this ugly ache. It cuts my breath away. I can't eat. I can't. Oh. I can't have anything to do with this. I can't think of you conscious. Suffering. Suffering. Oh. Don't, please. I can't. What can I do? What can I do? I would have stayed. You asked me to leave. It wasn't for me to stay. If it is over, as at any moment it might be, I can become good again. I can become something, at least for somebody. I'm good for nothing like this, least of all you. Maud.
Sir Luke is not here.
I couldn't wait.
No more could I. He arrives, travelling straight, tomorrow early.
It's over, isn't it?
Our dear dove, then, has folded her wonderful wings.
I knew.
Unless it's more true that she has spread them wider.
This morning, last night, suddenly I...
For flight, I trust, to some greater happiness.
I felt her absence.
Should you be alone... Or wouldn't this evening dine with me?
Shall you mind if I don't tell you at once?
Not in the least. Leave it open. I shall otherwise sit there alone.
Without Miss Croy?
Miss Croy has returned to the bosom of her immediate family.
She's left you?
We differed. And when Kate differs with you...
I know.
They've had the misfortune, I suppose you know, to have a dreadful, horrible father. He's almost too bad to name, and has come upon her sister, and Marian has shrieked for help.
Come upon her for money?
Oh, for that, of course, always. But also for refuge, for safety from God knows what. He's there, the brute. And Kate's with them.
Yours, then, after all, is rather better.
It's at least more decent. Come if you can.
If I can.
Where will you go?
I don't know. Don't leave me here. Oh, God. Don't leave me here. Millie. Thank you.
I feel so many things at seeing you in this place.
You didn't want to come.
It's not just a question of wanting.
You haven't decided what to do.
I have. Only with the sight of you here and what I seem to see in it for you. Your father's in the house.
In the house, yes. But we needn't fear his interruption. He's in bed.
You mean with illness?
Father's never ill. He's a marvel. He's only... endless.
When did he come?
3 days ago. After he hadn't been near her for more than a year. After he had apparently, and not regrettably, ceased to remember my sister's existence. In a state which made it impossible for Marian not to take him in.
In such want?
Not of food, not even, so far as his appearance went, of money. He looked as wonderful as ever. But he was, well, in terror.
Of what?
I don't know. Of somebody, of something. He wants, he says, to be quiet, but his quietness is awful.
What does he do?
He cries.
What has he done?
If you love me, now, don't ask me about Father.
I love you. It's because I love you that I'm here. It's because I love you that I've brought you this letter.
You've not broken the seal.
It's for you to break the seal.
To break the seal of something to you from her.
Because it's from her.
It's the proof.
Proof of what?
The beauty of which you have been loved. I won't break your seal.
You decline.
I know without.
What do you know?
She has made you rich.
She's left me her fortune.
Not all of it. It's immense. But money to a large amount. I don't care to know how much. I trust her.
Did she tell you?
Never.
Take it.
You want me to take it?
In Venice, you were capable of an act of splendid generosity for that. I give you this.
This is my reward.
It is everything I feel.
You've had to do yourself violence, haven't you?
So it is here you meet me. Take it.
You absolutely desire it.
I absolutely desire you to take it.
To do what I like with.
Short, of course, of making known its terms. That must remain between you and me.
To hold it is to know.
Oh, I know.
Well, then, if we both do, I don't need it. I'll place it in the fire where it belongs. You'll have it all from New York anyway.
I see a man. A young man, far off, so hushed, staying his breath but half understanding, dimly conscious of something immense happening, and holding himself so tight, so painfully, so as not to lose it. It's too distant. Too strange. He has my own face.
She will see you now.
Milly, every part of it I have gathered. The essence I can't coherently. It was like something huge. Like ice, like fire at the same time. It was a dove. The lightness of light itself is the word forgiveness. There is not a word enough. But whatever it was, it went through every sinew. She went through me. Or was I transparent? I saw the young man for the first time. I felt the air touch my face. And she...
Dear Merton. My dear Merton, do you remember the first moment? I love... Dear Merton, if I could... The money's the least part of it. It means nothing. Merton. I am in the library. My darling. I knew. I always knew. I didn't know. My darling Merton.
That I will never see her letter. That I will never see it, and yet I keep it so close. I take it out each day.
My dear Merton.
It is to me like a priceless pearl cast into the fathomless sea. I can hear it. It is a far faint wail.
Merton.
It is that sound I hold. I cherish when I am alone in my room. So this is what it takes to bring you to my rooms.
The letter you sent me, yes, I got it. This time I opened it, broke your seal.
It's not my seal. The good people of New York, it's theirs. I would have preferred to send it back unbroken, accompanied by a kind letter.
Is that what you're proposing we do?
Well, it's too late. Now with it open, we know.
Well, you don't know.
It would have been the best way.
You mean the unopened envelope would prove the refusal was not on the basis of the sum?
Something like that.
You didn't express that in your letter to me.
I wanted to leave it to you. To see what you'd do.
To see if I departed from delicacy.
To test you.
To see what I'm capable of. But now I know. I know how much...
Don't tell me.
Can you only do it blindly?
What do you think I'm going to do?
Refuse it. Isn't there some name for it? Not take up the bequest.
But there's something you forget in it. My asking you to join with me in doing so.
How can I join in a matter which has nothing to do with
you? How? By a single word.
What word?
Your consent to me giving it up. You're free to choose.
Do you not want to know how much? In your place...
What do you know of my place?
The facts will be published.
Published?
The papers?
I know how to escape that.
Your desire is to escape everything.
Everything.
And you still don't want to know how much.
I'm willing to believe it's not small.
It's worthy of her. It's what she was herself, if you remember what we once said.
Stupendous.
Stupendous. You see, I think you're afraid of all the truth. If you're in love with her without it, can you be more? And you're afraid. It's wonderful to be in love with her.
I never was in love with
her. For the time she lived, but the change came the day you last saw her. She died for you, that you might understand her. From that hour, you did. And now I understand her. She did it for us. I used to call her a dove. While she stretched out her wings, and they cover us.
They cover us.
That's what I give you. That's what I've done for you.
So you will.
Consent. For you'll marry me without the money, but you won't marry me with it. If I don't consent, you don't.
Well, you lose nothing else. I make over to you every penny.
So that I must choose.
You must choose.
There is one thing that can save you from my choice.
What is it?
Your word of honor. That you're not in love with her memory.
Oh. Her memory.
Don't speak of it as if you couldn't be. I would be in your place. Her memory's your love. You want no other.
I'll marry you, mind you, in an hour.
As we were?
As we were.
We shall never be again as we were.